game unbeaten streak. A win today would tie both all-time records. The Red Sox and Yankees play two games in London this weekend. Olympic Stadium reconfigured for baseball. The center field wall only 385 feet from home plate. But ESPN's Jessica Mendoza says there are other unique features in the park.
You hit a foul ball, there's going to be such a good chance that it'll be caught. It's the biggest stadium, that bigger than any stadium in MLB, even bigger than Oakland, 44,000 square feet.
Jessica Mendoza on Golic and Wingo. ESPN will carry Sunday's Yankees-Red Sox game at 10 a.m. Eastern. Police in the Dominican Republic say they have arrested the mastermind behind the shooting of David Ortiz. Victor Hugo Gomez allegedly ordered a hit originally on his cousin.
Great news. There's a quick way you could save money. Switch to Geico. Geico could help you get great coverage at a great price. And it only takes 15 minutes to see if you could save 15% or more on car insurance. Go to geico.com today and see how much you could save.
Brent Martineau.
You see him every day on CBS 47, Fox 30, Action Sports Jax.
Austin Lane.
He's a former Jag star and current MMA fighter.
Broadcasting live from the Anna Jar and Levine studio.
This is Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690 and ESPN690.com.
It is getaway day here on Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690. I mean, it must be something.
What's up?
I mean, what the heck are you wearing?
This is called a tank top.
You go from V-neck.
This is called
V-neck
a tank top.
Criticism?
No, I'm still hating.
Let's
go to the polls quick too. The polls are closing pretty soon, folks. So if you have a vote, get it in real quick on my Twitter. That's @trend_92. Let's go to the. Oh, what do you know? 60% says nay. 40% says yay.
You probably got like 13 votes.
We got 60 something votes. Nice try though, Brent. What's up,
man? You just get out of Gold's Gym?
No, man. It's just it's warm outside.
Is Gold's Gym still around?
I think there's gotta be Gold's Gym.
There's
Gold's Gym. This is kind of like our last day before we go on vacation a little bit. And as our coaches used to always tell us during OTAs and mini camps, don't have 1 foot in the parking lot. Well, I have 2 feet in the parking lot, and I have my eyes, I have my peepers on the USA soccer game. So I may not even be here today, as far as I'm concerned.
He is giving you 20% today.
Oh, yeah.
I hate those people.
At the very most, 20%.
I really hate those people.
Oh, I'll come ready. Don't worry. Just make sure it's
a good topic. I never understand the people that, like, kind of like my kids with school. It's like the end of school has to come at some time, and you're going to get like the days where it's like I'm doing nothing at school, but you can't just not take the whole day off. You got to go. You got to fulfill the requirement. So there's people like that, right? It's like, oh, I can't wait to get to vacation. I can't wait to get to vacation. I'm just the opposite. You know, the week before vacation, mm-hmm. and especially in this case, since I'm going for 2 weeks, is the most stressful week of the year.
Yeah. It's rough.
Well, it's
vacation's more the most stressful.
No, this week for me, because when we come back, it's football season. Now, I kind of do it to myself. I get it. But, I mean, this is the time we get to go away. So when you come back, it's on. And there's a lot of stuff behind the scenes that's got TV, radio, you know, especially now with all the stuff we're doing radio-wise that you're trying to get done. Mm-hmm. So you're not doing it on vacation all the time, although I probably will do a little bit of work, as my wife knows, although one of it will be a cruise. I'm not sure I'll be able to do too much work from the cruise ship.
Unless they have pretty good Wi-Fi there. We'll see.
Yeah.
Huh?
I've already got the daily plan, but
dude,
I don't know if
relax,
it's going to be very
man.
Good.
See, that's
it's
what I do.
Vacation,
you got to pick a spot, like, because I'm the same way. Like, if people start emailing me at work, even though I'm on vacation, I'll start like, even if I don't like acknowledge it, it'll be in my head and then I'll think about it. So I got to go somewhere where I don't really have like internet access.
I've always had this great respect for people who can just put it down.
Yeah.
Like I really do.
Thank you.
I genuinely mean that. Like,
thank you, Brent. I appreciate that, man.
Like,
it means a lot.
The guy that can open up his phone and have 39,355 emails unread.
Yes. Thank you very much.
That's like at the end of vacation, like on the drive or the flight back, I'll be thinking of how many emails I have to delete. And that's the part that like gets me worked up.
So when you guys go on vacation, are you guys the type that likes to plan everything out? Like, do you have an itinerary? Do you have a schedule? Or are you just more free-flowing, like, hey, let's do this today? I respect it because
let it
Brent,
ride. Whatever
Brent's
we do.
Got the whole itinerary posted out.
Well, I'm an itinerary guy day to day for the most part, although I didn't send you guys.
Didn't send us one for the show today, so who's really has it in the parking lot right now?
Yeah, I know. But my wife really is more the planner when it comes to vacation. I probably would be a little bit more freewheeling. I shouldn't say that. I'm guilty as charged. We went to Yellowstone last year, Wyoming. And I had it planned out and where we were going, and a lot of it because of the driving. But, yeah, I don't mind being planned out for it. The thing I don't like doing is getting too jacked up because I know it changes.
Sure.
You know, so you're not going to stick to your itinerary on vacation.
Of course
you're going to go stop and see people. Like when we go to Rhode Island, we'll go stop and see someone, and we'll spend four more hours there than we planned on staying, mm-hmm. and then that backs everything up. So you can't get too locked into your itinerary. Now, we're going on a cruise, man, so your itinerary is kind of done for you.
Good point.
You know?
Good point.
So that's one thing. But my wife is the person that goes to Disney, and she's been 100 times,
okay,
and she still goes, and she will take that damn map at Magic Kingdom,
yeah,
and she will start circling and crossing off.
Oh, man.
I mean, she and she doesn't matter how many times she's been. I would say, Steph, like, we have passes for the year. We can come back and do these. Nope. We got to get to as many freaking things as possible. She runs around Disney like she's 6 years old.
Yeah.
When we went recently, Nicole just looked on their app that like has like the wait times for each, and we just was like, all right, this one's the least. We're going there. And like, we just were all over the place.
Steph's
such
a Disney freak that she still watches. She'd probably tell you right now how long of a wait it is for Magic Kingdom.
Okay, she knows. Well, so do you guys do the express passes, or do you just go like the regular line?
Nah, we do. With the express pass, the fast pass thing, now you can go to like three of them, three rides at a time.
Oh, that's it? And the rest you got to wait?
There's like a cap on the fast pass.
I never really understood it,
but the fast pass is definitely worth it.
No,
the fast pass is worth it.
I'm talking about coups. You never understood the fast pass?
It confuses me. It's like, so it tells you a time to arrive, and then you still wait in line? Like, I don't understand.
No, it's like you get to kind of like cut the line, basically.
Yeah.
When you're waiting 3 hours to go on the Harry Potter ride.
Listen, time is money, man.
Yeah.
Time is money.
Don't ever end that, man.
It is the best.
You'll see.
Whatever it is. I don't even know what it costs right
now.
It's
worth it.
But it's the best. It's the best $70 or $80 or $90
stingy,
you can spend.
And this isn't Disneyland. This is, or Disney World. This is,
Six Flags,
Universal
maybe?
Studios.
Oh,
no,
because
we went for Halloween Horror Nights. We always go for Halloween Horror Nights. Okay. That's my big thing. And I tried to be stingy. Didn't use the fast pass. Imagine waiting 2.5 hours in a line to go through a 6-minute haunted house. Yeah. Never again. Never again.
No, so, I don't blame
fast
you.
Fast pass.
I mean, you got to get the fast pass. It's like it makes you cringe paying another whatever you're paying.
A doubt.
It's like, are you serious? But it's not worth the other side of it. By the end of the night, you're like, I wish I spent the $80.
Correct.
Or whatever it was.
Correct.
So anyway, vacations are coming. By the way, we'll give you a little programming update, what's happened the next couple of weeks. And then, man, we are getting close, right around the corner. And I'm not hurrying it here, but right around the corner, football season exists. Jawaan Taylor, by the way, we'll have a conversation with him. Marcel Robinson caught up with him yesterday at the Special Olympics event, and we didn't get to that yesterday. So we will share the rookie offensive lineman out of Florida. Some baseball topics today. The Rays are trying, man. They're trying to give away tickets.
I know.
We'll see if it works next week, but they're trying again. Forget about the $5 tickets. Now it's like $2 tickets and $2 concessions.
How about the fans just get paid to go to the games? Because that's what we're talking about right now. It's gotten that bad.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous.
It might get to that point.
Yeah.
Netting all around the fields in Major League Baseball. Looks like we're headed that way, and requirement to make it happen. Is that a good thing? Is it overdue? And what I get thinking about a little bit is, did they talk about this in like 1970? And why didn't they? Like, did people get hit back then? And why now? We've been playing baseball for a long time.
And I'd wonder the numbers and amount of people that have been hit this year, but could it have something to do with these new balls you're talking about?
Well, I think it's bigger, stronger, faster has to do with most of it. I think maybe the baseballs, but I think more so the bigger, stronger, faster part. And I think distractions, you know, and that is the phone that I'm holding up. So
true.
That's just a way of life. I'm not saying that's a bad thing. I have no problem with if people are looking on their phones, watching on Twitter a little bit, taking pictures. But the bottom line is their eyes are not up and watching all the game all the time. So I think that factors in. But I still, you wonder why this hadn't taken place before is my point. And it should. I like the idea of it. It's going to happen. It's really not that costly. It's more of a preference thing, and it's more of an old school kind of, I don't want that net in my way to see baseball. It feels like there's a separation between the field and the fan, and I get that to a degree. But the bottom line is, I don't want to be hit or my kid to be hit with a line drive going 110 miles an hour. So I think it's the right thing to do. Team USA playing France.
Megan Rapinoe just scored. So
early.
Hey, no one said the game had to be close. Underdogs, my you know what? They already scored 1-0 USA.
Wow, early. I mean, what's that?
Like the fourth match?
That's what we call a statement. Say what?
Were they actually underdogs?
Yes, yeah, they are. Plus 130.
Sounds like somebody wanted to lay some money down.
Sounds like someone wanted to put a couple $100 down on the website, but the website wouldn't let them do it because we're in Florida. And someone tried to go on maybe some black market websites, and they still won't let me do it. Just saying.
Man.
It may sound like that. Not saying that's what happened. But, yeah, I had a couple $100 burn a hole in my pocket that I couldn't spend, unfortunately. Now I'm kicking myself.
It'll be the greatest day when you can just pick up your app on your phone.
I know.
Or you can,
and
you
lose all my family's money. I can't wait.
We might have a kiosk right here in the studio.
Curling, whatever, cricket. Yeah. Go ahead and put $100 down. Yeah. I'm sure my family's going to appreciate that.
How many minutes are they in, seriously?
They're 9 minutes
and
in right
nine
now.
9 minutes in and yes. A score already. Megan Rapinoe.
Yeah.
We'll keep you posted on the United States soccer team going against France. Obviously, it's a huge one to stay in it and stay alive in the quest to win the World Cup. So, hey, we got a lot going on. We'll talk some football as well. NBA, we have a couple topics. This free agency this week, but it got me thinking on a couple of different levels. Kuz and I were just talking about it. Loyalty in sports because of free agency. And think about this one. We'll get to it a bit later on, but which sport, and I'm going to exclude hockey if you don't mind because of my ignorance more than anything,
okay.
But you can throw it in there if you want.
Okay.
Basketball, baseball, football has the best young stars, the best accumulation of young stars. And a little bit of that is because of the baseball all-star game starting lineups were announced.
Yeah.
And if you look at the young stars in the sport of baseball, that's where it got me thinking.
Mm-hmm.
And then on top of that, all the young stars and free agency in the NBA. But what about football? Wait a minute. Stars are out in football.
Saquon Barkley, Patrick Mahomes, just to name a few.
Think about that. We'll have that and much, much more. Plus, Paul Posluszny on the show on Action Sports Shacks on ESPN 690 today.
Action Sports Jax with Brent Martineau on ESPN 690 is brought to you by Best Bet Jacksonville and Orange Park.
It's Golic and Wingo.
I'm not talking like first, you know, rounding you bumped out or wild card game. I'm talking deep into the playoffs to save his job because I look at this team and I think the Jones family is at a point right now where they feel like they have young talent.
Mm-hmm. And time to make hay.
And it's time to make hay with this young talent right there and play at their highest level. So you're seeing the writing on the wall that this organization led by the Jones family is saying, listen, this is our time.
Right.
We need to win.
Golic and Wingo, weekday mornings at 6 Eastern on ESPN Radio and ESPN 2.
Want a fresh one? Renna's Pizza is made fresh daily. Everything they make. This summer, while you're making memories, let Renna's add to the fun. Having a pool party? Get Renna's. Don't feel like grilling out? Get Renna's Pizza. Coming back from the beach? Enjoy 2-for-1 happy hour Monday through Friday from 3 p.m. until 6 p.m. Hey, the same time as you listen to our show on ESPN 690. Stay fresh this summer with fresh food and a refreshing happy hour at Renna's Pizza. 5 locations, Marsh Landing, Bay Meadows, Argyle Forest, San Jose, and Neptune Beach.
Here's reason number 67 to choose Diamonds Direct over any other jeweler. Diamonds Direct is the only jeweler here with offices inside the World Diamond Exchange in Tel Aviv. You see, any jeweler can claim to be a direct importer or have so-called partnerships overseas, but the owners of Diamonds Direct have special access that others simply don't have. Nobody can get closer to the source than Diamonds Direct. Indeed, Diamonds Direct is recognized in the industry as a world diamond powerhouse with unrivaled buying power and decades of inside connections that go back to their roots as actual diamond cutters. Bottom line, Diamonds Direct is without question the jeweler here that can truly offer the absolute best value. We're talking direct importer prices on hand-select diamonds that come straight from the source. Make no mistake, Diamonds Direct refuses to be undersold on GIA-certified diamonds, and we challenge you to let us prove it. Diamonds Direct, your source for the ultimate diamond value. At the Markets at Town Center, official jeweler of the Jaguars.
In an ocean of car dealers, there's only one Atlantic Infiniti.
Only one Atlantic Infiniti.
The only one for a luxurious showroom.
Only one Atlantic Infiniti.
The only one with a stress-free buying experience.
Only one Atlantic Infiniti.
The only one fast, dependable service.
Follow the wave to the only one.
Atlantic Infiniti. 10980 Atlantic Boulevard.
We know with the right combination of sunny days, picnics, and trips to the lake, some summers can last a lifetime. We know the great outdoors. We love the great outdoors. Bass Pro Shops and Cabela's, where you can save big during our Star Spangled Summer Sale. Like select men's Henley shirts and logo t-shirts for under $10 each, and a Coleman 48-quart cooler for under $20. Bass Pro Shops and Cabela's. Your adventure starts here.
All right, it's time for some straight talk. You wouldn't pay $100 for seats to a baseball game when you can get the same seats for $50. So why pay more on your wireless when you can get the same 4G LTE networks for up to half the cost? For $45 a month, get our unlimited plan with 25 gigs of high-speed data from Straight Talk Wireless. No contract, only at Walmart.
Savings may vary. See terms and conditions at straighttalk.com.
Do you still have the ambitions to keep on coaching?
When I left South Carolina, I left in a bad way. But even during those years away, I said if maybe some kind of pro league would spring up.
Action Sports Jax with Brent Martineau. Weekdays from 3 to 6 p.m. on ESPN 690.
Hi, I'm Mike Mills from REM, and this is Action Sports Jax.
Just to update you, I killed the wasp.
Oh, you killed them?
Yeah, I was trying to eat your Altoids before you got in today.
Oh, Mr. Yeah, don't kill them. We just leave them alone, and now you killed them.
Yeah, I got tired of them.
Okay.
I didn't want to sit on them.
I think somebody got a little scared. It's all right, though, man.
I didn't want, like, the We Are the Millers moment to happen. Like, accidentally.
Yeah, I mean, that was a snake bite, but yeah, I guess same principles.
That was a spider bite.
Spider.
Oh, it was a spider bite. Was it a spider?
Yeah, tarantula, I think.
Oh, okay. I haven't seen that movie in a while. Forgive me.
That movie is hilarious.
Oh, classic, man. Jason Sudeikis is genius, as far as I'm concerned.
I really like that movie.
Yeah.
But that was a cringeworthy scene.
Yes, to say the least.
Without question. All right, here's the deal. Let's get into it right away. Just raised it.
Yep.
So Major League Baseball All-Star lineups announced yesterday, and it's littered with young talent all over the place. And see, that's the thing about Major League Baseball. We talk about branding and star power and marketability and transcend the sport. And we have that conversation in the past, like, yeah, you know, Mike Trout, he's unbelievable, but does he make waves all over the place? He's kind of a quiet guy. Bryce Harper can give you a little bit of that, but heck, he's hitting 230. There are some guys that do it, but not enough of them. Not like football, not like basketball, really. So, but the forgotten part about it is, I've argued many a times, I think baseball has this collection of young stars right now that might be generational. I mean, it's unbelievable how good some of the young players are in the game.
So when you say young stars, like, how young are we talking here? Like, their first 3 years? I mean, because, you know, that's pretty general statement.
It is pretty general. Yeah. I would say maybe a handful of years at most. Yeah, I mean, 2, 3, 4 guys that are rising, okay. You know, guys that have star power. Let's bring up a football guy. Who would I be thinking of?
Patrick Mahomes.
Like Mahomes, Saquon obviously. Barkley. But he's second year. Saquon Barkley, Wentz. Second year. Wentz is okay. Yeah, Wentz okay. And he's like, what, fourth year? I think that's fair.
Okay.
But I probably would rule out, like, Andrew Luck. Andrew Luck, he's younger than a lot of the old veteran quarterbacks, but he's not a young guy anymore.
Okay.
Right? Isn't he, like, 30 years old?
Seems
he's
like
he's been
it,
in the
yes.
league 8 years well, or something like that.
That's kind of the crazy part. Now that you think about it, you say, okay, so say it's 5 years. There's some guys in the NBA that could be 23 at 5 years in the league.
It is true.
Yeah. So that's the other side of it, too.
I understand. It's probably a difficult characterization because you feel like you should put Mike Trout in there, mm-hmm. but I'm not really sure I do put Mike Trout in there. He's been around like 8 years now. Mm-hmm. I mean, Trout's a stud and a star, but he's now been he's a veteran of Major League Baseball. So I don't really include him. So anyway, the question is baseball, football, basketball on the pro level, NBA, Major League Baseball, NFL, who has the best collection of stars right now? We're about to hit free agency in the NBA, and we know the NFL is a giant, and I'm leaving the NHL out. If you want to have a comment about the NHL and let us know about the stars, I'm just going to plead ignorance because I really don't know who the young stars are. Though it was fascinating, the top pick in the NHL draft is American.
Yep.
And that doesn't matter in this conversation. It doesn't matter if they're American, European, Canadian, whatever.
Yeah.
But anyway, that's the topic. Star 690 is the number, 904-362-9901. You can always chime in on all the platforms on social media right now. South Beach Gary, he's back 2 days in a row. What's happening, man? You got a comment on this?
Yes, the song of the day, first of all, has got to be The Gambler by Kenny Rogers.
Oh, that's a beauty. Great one. Did you do that for Austin?
Huh?
Did you do that for Austin since you wanted to lay down a wager?
No, I just had it in mind before that. I got to go with the NFL simply because the odds, you got 11 men on offense, 11 men on defense, and the influx of the draft every year, you know, the chances of, you know, the first round Major League Baseball players, you know, they're all going to go to the minors. It's going to be 2 or 3 years usually, even before the best of them make it to the major leagues. They got to spend some time in the minor leagues, and basketball is simply the sheer quantity of only 12 or 13 players on the team. But a couple things, guys, I want to switching gears on football. Is Clemson in trouble, anything for the PED usage, guys? Because I've heard rumors that 3 or 4 guys were caught with PEDs. Is the NCAA investigating them? And then Yannick, Austin, do you think Yannick would come in, say they're compromised, and say, look, I'll play for $17.5 million with the Jags, sign him tomorrow if his agent told him that. Thanks, guys. Have a great weekend.
No problem. Go ahead first, Brent.
Yannick
Ngakoue first. Listen, I think unless he doesn't make $100 million, he's not signing. And if you want to equate that to, I mean, you can average it out to how many years they sign him to. But it's going to be more than $17 million, I think, if he's going to make the $100 million. Just because, listen, it's not rocket science here. The market has been set, and that's just the way it is. You know, when Frank Clark gets over $100 million, when Lawrence from the Cowboys gets over $100 million, and then you have the same stats, if not better stats, than those two guys, unless Ngakoue wants to take a giant hometown discount, which I don't see him doing, which I don't see a lot of NFL players doing, especially a guy that's going to sign his first big contract, I just don't see it happening.
Yeah, I doubt he would, too. I mean, is there some level of hometown discount? And I mean, where does enough money become enough money? I mean, that's the agent's job, is to continue to drive it up. The agent's job is to keep the market in place, if not going up. The agent's job and the player's job is not to take a hometown discount. But at the end of the day, it's like, are they getting stuck at $99 million versus $97 million, or $17.8 million versus $17.5 million? I mean, if it's me, I'll be like, all right, let's do this. You know, yeah. And I could see Yannick, but like, let's do this. At the end of the day, the player has the option. Like, the player has to say.
It's his final call.
So,
yes.
I mean, from Gary's standpoint there, but keep in mind, there are some people that think $20, $21 million might be the annual of Yannick Ngakoue when he gets signed. He's not taking 17 and a half. It's not going to be that. So if it's somewhere between 19 and 21, it could be 19.2 instead of 20.8. Mm-hmm. But that might be the discount. It's not going to come a few million dollars less than what the market says.
I mean, let's think of any job here, Brent. Let's say, for instance, let's talk about your TV career. So let's say that.
Let's.
Yeah. So, yeah, let's get Brent paid. No, but so let's say, let's just go for the national as opposed to just the locals. I don't want to stomp anybody's toes or anything like that. So say you're a national sports guy. Okay. Yeah. And let's say that you have the best ratings. So let's say, like, you know, like the higher markets, like the top tiers, you have better ratings than those guys. So let's say you fit like in a tier two, and there's two other guys in that tier two that are right with you. They have good ratings as well, but you pull better numbers, and those guys have just got a new contract, but they get paid more than you have so far. Well, it's your time to get a new contract. Are you going to ask for more money, or you take a hometown discount? And then maybe you have a different philosophy, but what would you say? I mean, would you point to the ratings and be like, here's what I'm bringing to the table. Here's what these guys are making. I want to be compensated as such.
Yeah, yeah, I think so. Yeah, I think you certainly start there, right?
Yeah.
And now does there something else come into play? The one thing you do when you do that, even in, say, the ratings game or the sack game, and there's already this built-in nature of it anyway, but you apply extra pressure to yourself if you want to say, this is what I've done. That's the benchmark, which means you can basically hold me accountable if I don't do that. Mm-hmm. You know, that's the risk reward, you know, instead of looking at it in totality. Yeah. You know, like Yannick Ngakoue could say, hey, you know, I've got 29 sacks in 3 years. I'm going to get 29 more sacks in 3 years, or 11 more forced fumbles in 3 years. Or he could say, I'm going to also, even if I get 8 forced fumbles, and 25 sacks. I'm going to bring this, 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 and this to the table as well. My run game is getting better. My leadership, my this, you know what I mean?
His quarterback hits, too. Yeah. You know, like if you look at those numbers, I mean, don't get it twisted. Yes, sacks are the most important thing, but we're talking quarterback hits that directly affect the quarterback of, you know, throwing an interception, causing a fumble. I mean, quarterback hits are big as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, so anything, anywhere around the quarterback. That. So it's tough to equate ratings to sacks.
No,
and
I hear
my
you.
Salary to what Yannick's going to be.
And you know, Brent, and then that's the biggest problem.
I get paid
problem.
In tattoos.
Yeah. But that's the biggest problem, isn't it? That the casual NFL fan or the casual Jaguars fan is going to see, you know, a difference between maybe $3 or $4 million, and they're going to think, well, he's already making, you know, over $15 million, what's the big deal? And fans may not understand that, but you have to remember, I mean, this can be applied to any job. And yes, the job of NFL players making probably a lot more money than an everyday person, but at the same time, it's like I said before on the show, it's not about necessarily how much money you make. It's what the money represents. And that money representing is that we want you this bad. We want you just as bad as the Chiefs wanted Frank Clark. We want you just as bad as the Cowboys want DeMarcus Lawrence.
I actually think the best analogy to sports salaries, because we can't equate to that. I mean, again, you're talking tens of thousands of dollars versus millions of dollars.
Yes.
For most people. But I do think most people have bought a house before. Not most, but a lot of people have bought a house or sold a house before. Mm-hmm. And depending on the market you buy in and sell in, there's a comfort level where you are like, okay, it could land in here, and I feel like this is a good spot. I'd like to get this, but if we get this, that's okay. But it really sucks when you get lower than that.
Yes.
Right? There's this kind of, you get a little pissiness to you when it's like, dang, I thought I was getting this.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, and
or I thought I was going to buy it like this. Yeah. You
can't
really control
it. It's just the market.
It's just the way it is.
Yeah.
But it's like, you know, if you've done that before, you know the highs and lows of buying a house, depending on how many you've bought or sold. And that happens. You know, it's like, God, there's sometimes, I mean, you might pay, you know, whatever, even more than you thought you might have originally paid, but still feel like you stole it.
Yes, exactly.
You know what I mean? Yeah. It's just more of a feeling, because by then you're not talking about numbers. Mm-hmm. I mean, in the grand scheme of things, if you buy a house, what's the difference between $2,000? I mean, you're probably talking about 40 cents in your payment.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Over 30 or whatever it might be. So it's kind of like that with these player salaries. South Beach Gary brought up Clemson story. I don't know if there's any further investigation. I think what he's referring to is that basically Dabo Swinney and Clemson have said they're not revealing what the findings, their own investigation into what the three players who got popped for PED around national championship time, what the findings were. Yeah. And making those public.
I know there was rumors saying that their tainted supplements was what my understanding was, which can go through a bunch of litigation, because I think that's big in the UFC right now, too, is the tainted supplements thing. So.
Yeah, so I don't see – they're citing the privacy law at Clemson. So And if he's asking, is there a bigger issue there, I kind of look at this kind of case when you get three guys that get popped where they all kind of like – talking to each other, you know, where it's kind of rare to see that in college football right now. I mean, you know, you had Will Greer at Florida, but that was a one-off thing. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't really see three guys in the same team get popped. Well, to me, it's like the fraud thing that happened at Florida a couple years back. It's like they were all in on it and somehow got caught into that web, and maybe these guys at Clemson did too. I bottom line for me, South Beach Gary, I don't think all of a sudden the NCAA is all over Clemson saying how many people are using steroids and illegal drugs over there.
But at the same time, the issue that I had problem was like, you know, I think Dabo came out and said, I don't know if they're taking the supplements independently or if it was part of the strength and conditioning program. What I assumed was they're taking them independently and they were tainted supplements. So what tainted supplements means basically is that they may be a cheaper supplement where, you know, you think of these big factories where they make creatine, branched chain amino acids. Well, they all come from the same factory. And sometimes one ingredient accidentally gets added to another ingredient. So like, you know, there's a little leftover, I guess. And that's how the supplements become tainted. And it was my understanding that's what happened at Clemson. Now, if that's the case, well, so be it. But it still makes you look pretty bad as a strength and conditioning program, where if your players aren't taking the necessary steps in order to take the proper supplements, because there are, you know, like the NSF certified supplements out there, and it's your job as a strength coach, it's your job as a head coach of a football team to try to endorse those supplements, because those supplements have been tested, they are good to go. So regardless of what the excuse is, if the players just took them independently, if there was miscommunication, it still makes you look bad regardless. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, and by the way, if it happens again to Clemson, then you might be onto something, you know. But I just don't think it's there yet, in my opinion. I haven't seen that. All right. How about the question I asked? Who's got the best group of young talent in pro sports? Baseball, football, basketball. Right now, the vote says football. I've got a vote going, too. It's not V-necks or muscle shirts.
you lost that one. Tank
was that a muscle
women.
Shirt or tank top?
Dude, it's a tank top. What more do you want from me?
Like, what's the difference? Is there a difference? Muscle shirt, tank top?
Well, I feel like a muscle shirt you can, like, cut down a little bit so you like the sleeves are bigger. Kind of, you know. This is fitted to my chest, so we're all good.
I don't like the tank top. I haven't worn a tank top since I was, like, 3.
I'm sorry to hear that.
But I do like the Rocky hoodie.
Oh, yeah, the Rocky
I want to get
good.
An ESPN 690 one of those.
Let's get it.
All right, who's got the best group of young talent? And how many tattoos does Austin Lane really have? You can see it on the video platforms now.
Action Sports Jax with Brent Martineau. Weekdays from 3 to 6 p.m.
We're happy to be joined by Jenna Lane of ESPN.
It's actually my first time interacting with Austin, too, so no relation here.
Well, Jenna, that was my first question was, have you been to any family reunions in Chicago? Because I don't think I've ever seen you before. I just wanted to make sure, though.
And by the way, Jenna, let's just make this perfectly clear. It's a really good thing you're not related to Austin.
Oh, wow, Brent.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh,
wow. That's how you feel about it. Okay,
it's
Brent.
Just a really good thing.
Off to a good start.
On ESPN 690.
At Diamonds Direct, we love those who serve and protect us. And it shows with our new and even more generous Heroes in Uniform program. This is for all active military and veterans, plus all first responders. You get exclusive price discounts on any purchase, plus exclusive long-term 0% financing with no money down options. This is available year-round. It can be used for virtually anything. It's our way of honoring our hometown heroes, those who serve our country and our community, those who make the daily sacrifice, who work hard protecting us, who spend so much time away from their families. To these special men and women, we invite you to our showroom, where you'll be treated with respect, you'll be honored, and you'll get our guaranteed best price value, plus extra discounts as well as 0% long-term financing with nothing down. If you wear a uniform and are among those who serve and protect us, or you're a veteran, all of us at Diamonds Direct stand with you. Because at Diamonds Direct, we know that sound is not noise. It's the sound of freedom. Diamonds Direct. Get store hours and directions at diamondsdirect.com.
Luxury begins at the door of Atlantic Infinity with your concierge, no-pressure customer experience. There's only one new Atlantic Infinity showroom designed to deliver an ocean of comfort, convenience, and speedy attention by their professional sales and service staff.
Ride the wave to Atlantic Infinity.
You deserve the wave of luxury that Atlantic Infinity is designed to deliver.
Only one Atlantic Infinity.
Experience the wave of luxury in person at 10980 Atlantic Boulevard or at AtlanticInfinity.com.
The lowest fee in real estate is coming soon to Jacksonville. There's no longer any reason to pay 6% to sell your home. Introducing Rex. Rex sells homes for the lowest fee in the industry. 2% total, saving thousands of dollars per transaction. With Rex, you get a full-service team backed by technology. They don't market homes the way traditional agents do. Rex uses advanced digital marketing tactics to directly target hundreds of qualified buyers to your home the moment it goes on the market. And Rex charges only 2% total, not the 6% commission your local broker expects. Get started now by calling 833-REX-HOME. That's 833-REX-HOME. Since 2015, Rex has saved homeowners millions of dollars in fees across California, Texas, New York, and Colorado. Now it's your time, Jacksonville, to sign on for a simplified and cost savings approach to buying or selling a home. To get started, call now at 833-REX-HOME. That's 833-REX-HOME. Rex Real Estate Exchange Incorporated.
Can it be right that one out of every six people on Earth bribes a police officer each year? Why is everyone looking
Which
at me?
Which one of you bribed an officer?
Come on.
Stugatz.
Yeah. Of course. You answered your own question.
Yeah, of course. Yes, you're right.
Did it this
Stupid
morning.
Question. Yeah.
58% of the audience said no.
Do you want more from the Dan Le Batard Show? Download the podcast right now on iTunes or on the ESPN app.
Join ESPN 690 at the River City Wrestling Con from 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. this Saturday, June 29th at the Jacksonville Fairgrounds, featuring Kevin Nash, Scott Hall, Arn Anderson, and a special interview with Ricky the Dragon Steamboat.
Brent Martineau.
You see him every day on CBS 47, Fox 30, Action Sports Jax.
Austin Lane.
He's a former Jag star and current MMA fighter.
Broadcasting live from the Anajar and Levine studio.
This is Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690 and ESPN690.com.
All right, the vote is 51% for football, 28% baseball, 21% basketball. It's still early. A couple more hours to go in the voting on social media. Check it out on at Brent AS Jax. So we have 76 votes in so far. But let's continue the conversation. Off the top of your head, I mean, we're not going to sit here and go run through every single player. But which sport do you think would have the best group of young talent?
Well,
baseball, football, basketball.
Before we get into it, because these are the major sports, I got to give props to extreme sports as well, though. Like snowboarding and skateboarding, Brent, there's like 12, 13-year-olds that are winning X Games in the Olympics.
But you almost don't have old people in those sports.
Rare.
Somebody like over 30 years old.
Oh, I don't know about that. I got you. Like skateboarding, they're still like the old school type too that competes in like street competitions. But I get what you're saying, yeah. But I had to give props to the young kids that are snowboarding and skateboarding because it's insane. Me overall, I would almost like when you said that, like when you said the question, I was leaning towards the NBA just because. You can be a rookie, you can be a first-year guy or second-year guy and win the MVP. Now, don't get me wrong, Patrick Mahomes did that with the Kansas City Chiefs, so that kind of goes against my argument a little bit. I would probably pump the brakes on baseball for sure. If we're talking like the first 3 years, yes, there are stars, but are they MVPs right away? I think with baseball, you can have some older people that can still win the MVP along with like football. Now, in basketball, I mean, when's the last time LeBron James won the MVP? A couple years ago, three or 4 years ago, because Steph Curry kind of took over. So for me, from I guess the quote-unquote young man's game, I'm going basketball, NBA. Because look at Giannis. You know, Giannis just won the MVP.
That's a good call.
I mean, you could argue for either one, in my opinion. But I think baseball is the outlier here.
You know what's interesting to me as I dive into this a little bit more? Is it just feels like the baseball guys are younger to me.
Yeah.
Like Trout, he's 8 years. He doesn't feel old. He feels still like a young star. Bryce Harper's 24, man.
I know.
But he's been around for a long time. To your point about basketball, yeah. You can get that too. George Springer feels like a young guy. That Astros team feels young for all the core players, but it's really not anymore. Mm-hmm. Like, they're not that young by these standards, you know? I mean, like I said, it's hard to put a... Is it 5 years? Is it 7 years? Whatever it might be.
Well, they also seem so young, though, too, Brent, because they all kind of came up in the farm system together.
They do.
You know, like, the Astros team built from the farm system. So, like, when they first come up, it's like, oh, who are these newer guys coming from the, you know, like the AAA leagues? But, yes, they have been playing baseball for a while.
Think about Mookie Betts feels like a young guy, right? He's not really super young. Yeah. I mean, he's not, like, young. But then you got the Cody Bellingers. You have the Ronald Acuna's of the world. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, you got those kind of players. Like Acuna and Bellinger's MVP potential. Yep. Yelich, to me, doesn't feel young anymore.
Me neither.
I mean, he's been around quite a bit. Mm-hmm. Acuna, though, is one of the most exciting, if not the most exciting players in the game. But you bring up a good point because now you're top heavy with Giannis. But what other star? I mean, now you're thinking Zion Williamson.
Luka, Trae Young, both those guys, I mean, they're going to be stars. And they're already, you know, moving the needle at least.
That's good. That's true.
And they're going on year two now.
What would he classify Anthony Davis?
He's still pretty young.
He's a pretty young guy, right?
But then on top of that, you have Zion. Zion hasn't even played yet. Zion hasn't even played yet, but, I mean, people are acting like he's a star.
Yeah.
Ben Simmons.
See, I think Joel Ben Simmons Embiid. Good. Yeah, all
so
those guys.
Anthony
all
Davis that, is going this, on.
His, yeah.
Anthony Davis will be going on his sixth NBA season. See, to me, that's not young.
Yeah, it's not young.
With all due respect
to Mr. Davis.
Count.
Yeah.
Football to me has actually the. I know we mentioned Mahomes and Saquon Barkley, but in my mind, because the league from a face of the league standpoint is Tom Brady, Drew Brees, Aaron Rodgers.
Yeah.
It's all Philip Rivers. Mm-hmm. It's all these young quarterbacks. Now Mahomes sneaks in there, and Barkley sneaks
Carson
in
Wentz
there.
Probably
Carson
sneaks
Wentz.
In there.
I still believe is a young player. I would put him as
I'll
young.
I'll give that to you.
I mean, is there a young receiver in the game? Like Odell Beckham Jr. is not a young player anymore, is he?
No, I wouldn't consider him young.
Is he a young stud at receiver?
I wouldn't consider Antonio Brown. Probably Juju Smith-Schuster
would
be the young guy.
Good. That's a good call.
But he's also on, I think his fourth season?
How old is Hopkins?
But he's young. Hopkins, veteran.
Older? Okay.
Hopkins wouldn't fit the bill. Defensively, like here in Jacksonville, you got a bunch of them. You got Jalen and you got Miles Jack. See, they're still young. I mean, they're on their first contracts.
Yeah,
maybe that's the best way to characterize
it.
Is
first contract.
First contract.
Mm-hmm.
Yannick Ngakoue is another great example.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I guess you have a balance in all leagues. But it's a tough thing to answer.
You do, but then you like you said, Brent, you have people like Tom Brady winning MVPs. You got people like Drew Brees who are like the crafty vets, that are still getting all the awards. And while with the NBA, Michael Thomas from Saints, that's a great example, Kuz. Good call. But then you think about like the NBA, I mean, yes, LeBron James is still an MVP candidate every single year. I don't know if you consider Steph Curry a young guy or an older guy now, but I would say
he's older guy now.
Okay.
Yeah.
But I just feel like the next generation now, and with James Harden too as well, he's kind of a veteran. But I just think with the talent coming out in the NBA every single year, you have to go
What
NBA.
If you really took a deep dive with like running backs though? Because it's usually a younger.
Well, that's a young man's position. Yeah.
That's what I
Elvin
mean.
Kamara.
And so maybe that would, even Fournette. I mean, it kind of.
Kamara, Fournette, Gurley.
Yeah.
Although Gurley feels a little bit older now, yeah. Right? I mean, he's gotten on year five. That's kind of old. If he's around,
did you say Elliott?
No, I didn't. Elliott's a good call.
Zeke Elliott's a good call.
So, your running backs are where it's at.
That's where you get young,
or quarterbacks. I mean, you think young, you think quarterbacks and running backs. Now the quarterbacks could be busts and not have worked out, but Mahomes is helping that out. Wentz is helping that out. Heck, Jared Goff just went to a Super Bowl. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's got to be helping that out to some degree. Although I don't think there's anybody. What a great. He's like an anomaly, isn't he? Anybody that goes to a Super Bowl, you automatically put them in this category like, wow, that guy's a stud. He's going to be a star. Jared Goff does not get that outlook.
No.
He does not, right? Is that just me?
Because everyone considers Jared Goff a quote-unquote system quarterback. Like, he fits
the
system. Yeah, but, well, okay, call him that. But guess what? It's a really great system in Sean McVay. I mean, if anybody came to play, Blake Bortles would be a system quarterback if you ever played. It's just... I hate the term system quarterback because it's almost implying like he's a robot and he's just going by what the head coach tells him to do. That's not the case at all. Jared Goff's making the calls. He's making the audibles with that run past option. So I think Jared Goff's a great quarterback, but he just doesn't get any love because of Todd Gurley and the rest of pieces that they have of that team.
Well, he certainly played well enough. I do have my doubts about Jared Goff in terms of how good he is in the grand spectrum of QBs. By the way, the young guy we kept left out is Baker Mayfield. Now that again we continue to talk about this, and you actually see both sides of the spectrum, right? A lot of star power that are veterans, basketball, football, and I think baseball's like that too. See, I would say veteran wise, like a Freddie Freeman guy feels like a veteran. Yelich is starting to feel like a veteran. You still have star power. I mean, Clayton Kershaw still one of the top pitchers. Verlander, pitcher in the game. Those are veteran guys. But then you mix it with this youth. Maybe the best way to kind of figure this out is who has the best selection of players that are in their prime.
Yeah.
Which is that middle ground, which is really like a second contract kind of deal.
Here's the thing, though, Brent. Think about it like this way. How many pick your sport where a rookie comes in and you basically build your entire team around that rookie? Even with the Chiefs, they didn't do that with Patrick Mahomes. They knew they had something special with Patrick Mahomes. They didn't do that. He sat at the bench. With Saquon Barkley, I don't think they really did that with Saquon Barkley. I think the jury was like, well, yeah, he's going to be a good running back, but I don't think anybody expected him to be that good. Same thing with Christian McCaffrey. There's another young guy we haven't mentioned, Christian McCaffrey.
True.
But you look at like Zion, you look at these guys that come out of the NBA draft every single year, especially those top picks. I mean, teams will literally trade away some of their star vets just to build around that young talent. And when you're talking about that, I feel like you have to go with
the
NBA.
Well, the NBA is so unique in this sense. You really only need 7 or 8 players.
That's true,
as
too.
A whole.
That's true.
And I'm not even talking about studs. I'm just talking about key contributors.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously the NFL is not like that. You need 25 guys. Major League Baseball isn't like that. You need about 22 guys from a pitching staff to everybody else to be pretty darn good. But in football, it has happened too. Andrew Luck, I would put in that category. I think Cam Newton was in that category where they drafted a guy and built around that guy. Baker Mayfield is now there. The addition of Baker Mayfield and what he showed last year forced not force, but help Dorsey and the folks in Cleveland say, let's go get Odell Beckham Jr. Let's go take chances on these guys. Let's go get it because we think we got a guy and the window has already started.
Make no mistake about it, though, Brent. There's a reason why NBA players, most of them come out as freshmen because they had that opportunity. They play 1 year in college and then to the NBA. College football, it's a little different. You got to play a couple years in college football and then go to the NFL draft. So you're going to come in a little more mature, a little more older with the game of basketball. I think you can get away with being a little younger as well.
Yeah. The fascinating thing, and maybe this really just circles back to the game has changed because of branding so much that you're aware of young guys, where young guys used to have to sit out and wait their due and wait until the veteran would hand the torch off. But all three of these leagues we're talking about, and hockey's probably included in this, are really healthy with young players. And what looks to be a pretty good balance between the veterans and the young players. Team USA, what's the update?
1-0 with about a minute left in the half.
All right, 1-0 over France for now. We'll give you some more updates along the way. We'll talk a little Daytona. Big race next week coming up next. Hey, everybody, this is Brent Martineau from Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690 and, of course, on CBS 47 and Fox 30. If you catch us on the radio, hopefully you tune in 3 until 6, Monday through Friday, and you can catch us on TV on the weekend as well. Saturday and Sunday nights, Action Sports Jax primetime. The entire Action Sports Jax team, including Stuart Weber and Marcel Robinson, on Saturday nights. 10:30 on Fox 30, 11:30 on CBS 47, Action Sports Jax primetime, and during the week on ESPN 690. It is the home of the 2019 Action Sports Jax Dream 18 Golf Tournament, and it can be the home of your golf game, too. Hey, everybody, this is Brent Martineau. I'm talking about the golf club at Southampton in St. Johns County, located off County Road 210. Family-owned and operated. I just played there a couple times last week. It's in great shape. Find out how you can get 2 free months of full golf membership. All you have to do for more information is call Southampton at 904-287-PLAY. That's 904-287-PLAY. Want a fresh one? Renna's Pizza is made fresh daily. This summer, while you're making memories, let Renna's add to the fun. Having a pool party? Get Renna's. Don't feel like grilling out? Get Renna's Pizza. Coming back from the beach? Enjoy 2-for-1 happy hour Monday through Friday from 3 p.m. until 6 p.m. Hey, that's the same time as you listen to our show on ESPN 690. Stay fresh this summer with fresh food and a refreshing happy hour at Renna's Pizza. 5 locations, Marsh Landing, Bay Meadows, Argyle Forest, San Jose, and Neptune Beach.
Like a lot of guys approaching a milestone anniversary, Marcus Hall came to Diamonds Direct looking to upgrade his wife's diamond, celebrating their 10 years of marriage.
We knew when we first got married, we settled on what we got, and it was time, so that's why I came in.
Marcus thought he could afford to upgrade to a full carat, maybe a carat and a half, but because of Diamonds Direct's amazing no middleman pricing, he walked out with a stunning 2-carat diamond.
Crazy the deal that we got. I felt that it was very fair. Couldn't believe I was able to get into a ring like this, let's put it that way.
And even though he hadn't been in a jewelry store in over a decade, Marcus loved how easy the staff at Diamonds Direct made it.
Very honest, very sincere, kind staff, well-trained, very knowledgeable. What I thought was going to be a stressful situation actually ended up being completely pleasant, and they helped me get into the perfect, ideal engagement ring, 2-carat diamond.
Diamonds Direct, your love, our passion.
They're going to help guide you in the right direction.
At the markets at Town Center, official jeweler of the Jaguars.
If Toronto loses Masai, in all likelihood, they lose Kawhi. If they keep Masai, Masai may end up keeping Kawhi. He might pull it off.
The Stephen A. Smith Show, weekdays from 1 to 3 p.m. on ESPN 690.
Hi, this is Grayson Marshall Jr., 2016 ACC legend, and you're listening to ESPN 690.
1-0 Team USA over France.
Nil, Brett. It's called nil, actually, in soccer.
And it's a match.
It's all right, though. You'll learn.
I just don't. I mean, do we have...
Careful now, Brent.
Do we have the fever?
I mean, you see me here, man. Tank top. I almost wore a red, white, and blue tank top, but it was dirty, so I couldn't rock that one. Yes, Brent, I have the fever. I don't know about you, man.
Yeah, I'm talking about the masses, man.
You know what? Surprisingly, not as much as I felt in the past.
Yeah.
Which is weird to me because I remember I think back in 2010 was the World Cup for the men, and that seemed like, I mean, everyone was talking about that.
That was crazy.
And this is talking about...
like, that was a lot of fun.
Yeah, but it's a men's U.S. team that wasn't expected to really even, you know, make the final stages or anything like that.
No, but so, it was like the whole thing ramped up.
Yeah.
For that. The bars around here were great. I mean, it was cool.
Yeah.
It was the whole Vuvuzela... Oh, yeah. Thing. Is that how you say that?
You're close enough. Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to pronounce it.
But yeah, it was that felt like soccer was about to take a leap in the States.
It did
that time that summer. I think it was more like might have been 2012. I don't know what it was, but
I think it was 2010 because I remember I was a rookie and I was in an extended stay, and me and my roommate.
Oh, so it was 2010.
Me and my roommate Larry Hart were watching it.
Okay,
yeah.
Larry.
Yep.
You know, and I guess I think there's plenty of fever for it. I'll check the ratings today and see how it does. It's on Fox 30 this afternoon. But I just don't get the sense it's like that. The bars aren't filled and people aren't like, well, now I do think as you get to the semis and the championship, and if that happens for the United States, I think it could turn into that. And of course, next week's 4th of July and Independence Week. And,
but with all due respect, this is the biggest game of the whole.
This is the biggest game.
Yeah, because whoever wins this one's more likely to win. But the casual fan doesn't. I guess.
You know what I mean? Casual fans knows when they're playing for a cup.
I got
you. When they're one win away, they're two win away, two wins away. They don't know France like you know France.
You're right.
No, I will say there's a few people here at work that were actually upset. They were trying to get everything done early enough to make it out to the beach bars to be watching this. And
really?
You know, right before I came in, I was like, oh, you didn't make it out there. And they're like, no, I have to work. And
hey, listen, like, yeah, right. I might be – I'm just asking. I don't know what the pulse is. I don't feel it as much as I have in the past. I think there's a couple of things at work, too. A couple of things are at work.
USA is just so good.
USA has been good.
Yeah.
Have they lulled us to sleep on the women's side? And the fact that the men made us turn it off last year, they didn't even make it in their World Cup.
But this, at the same time, though, to counteract that point, the last Olympics, the USA got beat by Sweden, if I'm not mistaken, and they were bounced out of the gold medal game because of that. So I think, and you're seeing this with the women now playing for the World Cup, I mean, there is a little bit of redemption since they had a pretty bad Olympics because the expectations was to win the gold medal, obviously.
Yeah. So, halftime yet?
I believe so, yes.
Almost halftime. Yeah, 1-0 halftime. United States in the lead over France. We'll continue to update you. Hey, next week, Independence Day, tradition at Daytona. For the last time at Daytona, there will be a summer race during the 4th of July week. Action Sports Jack's Stuart Weber caught up this week with the president of International Speedway Corporation, Daytona International Speedway, one of their tracks, Chip Weil. Here's the conversation.
And now joined by Chip Weil, the track president down at Daytona, as we are a week away from Daytona in the summertime. I know you guys are excited, and all the race fans here in Northeast Florida can't wait.
I can't believe we're already talking about the Coke Zero Sugar 400. Looking forward to having race fans from all over the country converge in Daytona Beach on Saturday night, July 6th, for the 61st running of the Coke Zero Sugar 400. It's such an incredible race. It's very different than the 500. Obviously, it's under the lights. It's 100 miles shorter. But just the intensity seems to pick up early in that event. And you never know who's going to win. Last year, we had a first-time winner with Eric Jones. The year before, Ricky Stenhouse, guy you probably wouldn't have picked to win. So it's a very unpredictable race. Always a great day out at the Speedway.
I'm pretty sure, by the way, Eric Jones won last year because he hosted the media rides a couple weeks before. So, David Ragan, Kurt Busch, both have made appearances at Daytona leading up to the race.
It's a thing.
Put your money on those guys we get ready for the race. It's been a few weeks now since the future schedule came out and kind of revealed that this is the last time, at least for the foreseeable future, that the race is going to be on Independence Day weekend. Yeah. What has the reaction been to that? I know everybody's excited because now it's the last race before the playoffs, which, you know, makes a lot of sense because you're going to get a lot of volatility and a lot of excitement at Daytona. What has been kind of the overall reaction that you guys have gotten from fans?
I mean, both fans and competitors understand the move. They're excited about the move. I think, you know, it's certainly something where we all recognize how important the 4th of July weekend is and to our sport and being in Daytona. But we also got to continue to push forward. And you look at what NASCAR is doing with the point system, with the new car. We got to continue to to evolve and change. And so I think starting the regular season in Daytona and finishing the regular season in Daytona makes a heck of a lot of sense. And we're looking forward to hosting race fans next August. I almost said July, August. And it'll certainly be a great way to cap off the regular season of the NASCAR season.
As for the actual racing on the track, we hear so much about how different it is from that February race, and it brings that excitement level. You know, you're pumped up to see who is going to be at the front, and as you mentioned earlier, just about anybody can, which might be a little nice change of pace. We've had kind of the same guys just battling for those wins so far this year with Truex and Kyle Busch and Joey Logano, sure, just week after week after week being these really strong drivers. Daytona's a little bit different, though, and we'll see that at the race.
Well, you looked at Michael McDowell coming with two to go to finish the Daytona 500. He had a chance to win, and Michael McDowell, as you all know, isn't a guy that typically runs up front on a regular basis. You know, there's just so much unpredictability in this race, and I remember when I worked on the race team side of the business, when you walked up to the race car to get your driver after the event, he wasn't sweating, but he was emotionally and physically drained. You know, you think about all the things they have to process in such a short period of time to try to get to victory lane. It's remarkable. And you can pick one of 40 drivers and you have an equal chance to win. And that's what makes Daytona so exciting. The plate racing, fans love it. You know, they're five and six wide, four and five deep in it, and you just don't know what's going to happen. So certainly looking for fireworks on and off the racetrack next Saturday night. If you haven't gotten your tickets, they start at $49, so really a reasonable way for people to come out and enjoy a great night of racing. DaytonaInternationalSpeedway.com or by calling 1-800-PIT-SHOP. Make sure you don't miss the race next Saturday.
Hard to beat those prices and hard to beat the fact that it's under the light. So it won't be as hot as it has been here around Jacksonville the past few days. Chip Wild, thank you so much for stopping in.
Thanks for letting me be on.
Thanks, Stuart Weber. Catching up with Chip Wild, the Daytona International Speedway president. Big week next week, of course. 4th of July week and Daytona International Speedway. Big time tradition. And as those guys were just talking about, it will be moving to the end of August, starting in 2020, but still a fun time, part of your Independence Day week, at least in these parts. And hey, once again, you can get us on ESPN 690 AM all the way down to Daytona. In fact, all the way down to the Melbourne, Florida area. We're going to take a time out here on Action Sports Jacks on ESPN 690. When we come back, a little balling and falling. Update on Team USA as they are a half away from advancing, but a lot of work left to do. NBA free agency this weekend. How about a little loyalty conversation? And it actually does come back to Jacksonville. If you think about all these different contracts that are up right now or coming up in the next couple months, how much of a factor is loyalty in sports anymore, or does it not matter one bit at all? We'll talk all about it next on ESPN 690.
Show podcast.
So when you poke a bear, the bear just walks off initially and waits, and then he comes back later.
Now the bear wants you to get very comfortable, and then the bear strikes.
The bear spends the first half just sort of searching for the cooler, and then in the fourth quarter the bear mauls you. That's what happens. mauls your face.
Do you want more from the Dan Le Batard Show? Download the podcast right now on iTunes or on the ESPN app.
Hey, everybody, this is Brent Martin along with Austin Lane. Leave your troubles ashore. Live the island life with the citrus of the sea, Vida de Luis Tequila.
The new Vida de Luis Tequila is made from natural volcanic spring water.
It has no aldehydes. If you're wondering what aldehydes are, they are what cause the bad hangovers and headaches.
Vida de Luis is the smoothest tequila around. For location, recipes, and merchandise, visit VidaDeLuis.com.
Must be at least 21 to drink Vida de Luis. Find Vida de Luis in your favorite bars, restaurants, and liquor stores. Enjoy Vida de Luis responsibly.
4th of July is fast approaching. And you know what I heard? No, not fireworks. I heard that my friends over at Arlington Toyota are going to make your payments until after Labor Day. Free yourself from car payments this July 4th and buy a new Toyota from Arlington Toyota and make no payments until after Labor Day. During the Summer is on Us July 4th event, not only are you going to get a payment-free summer, you'll also get mind-blowing low pricing on 2019 Toyota models. This July 4th, drive away in a 2019 Corolla LE from Arlington as low as $13,881. That's a pre-owned 2019 Corolla for $13,881. Get 4th of July savings on a 2019 Camry LE starting at just $17,991. Yep, Arlington's got your pre-owned 2019 Camry for $17,991. Want a truck? Get a truck. as in 2019 Tacoma SR5 double cab from just $24,881. It's a pre-owned 2019 Tacoma for $24,881. It's the July 4th Summers on Us sales event, and it's going on now at Arlington Toyota. Sales is open all day on the 4th. Start shopping now at arlingtontoyota.com. Broadcasting live from the ESPN 690 Anna Jar and Levine Studios. Anna Jar and Levine Accident Attorneys. Call 904-600-4000. That's 904-600-4000. ESPN 690, Jacksonville's home for ESPN Radio. WOKV Jacksonville. Listen live everywhere you go on ESPN690.com. ESPN 690, a Cox Media Group station.
I'm Doug Brown. At the Women's World Cup quarterfinals, at the half in Paris, Team USA leads France 1-0. The goal in the fifth minute on a free kick from Megan Rapinoe. ESPN's Adrian Wojnarowski reports the Warriors will offer Klay Thompson a max contract on Sunday. It'll be for 5 years, $190 million. Thompson will miss some or all of next season after a torn left ACL in the finals. Police in the Dominican Republic say they've arrested the mastermind behind the shooting of David Ortiz almost 3 weeks ago. Victor Hugo Gomez now being detained. Last week, police said they thought Gomez was living in the U.S. Ortiz is still hospitalized and recovering in Boston. We're a little more than 48 hours away from opening the NBA free agent market. What will the Lakers do next? ESPN's Brian Windhorst.
What I've been told is they have a relatively simple, if audacious, plan. They want Kawhi Leonard or Kyrie Irving, and if they don't get one of those two, they're going to probably break it up.
Brian Windhorst saying the Lakers' plan B would be trying to sign lower-priced players.
Think O'Reilly Auto Parts for all of your car care needs. We're close, convenient, and known for our guaranteed everyday low prices and excellent customer service from professional parts people you can trust. Stop by your local O'Reilly Auto Parts today. O'Reilly Auto Parts. Better parts, better prices every day.
Brent Martineau.
You see him every day on CBS 47, Fox 30, Action Sports Jax.
Austin Lane.
He's a former Jag star and current MMA fighter.
Broadcasting live from the Anna Jar and Levine Studio.
This is Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690 and ESPN690.com.
1-0 Team USA over France. That's the big story here on a Friday. Everybody with eyes near the Eiffel Tower to see if the United States can win a big soccer match on the women's side in the Women's World Cup. So we'll continue to keep you posted. Halftime, or they're getting ready to go for the second half probably pretty shortly. So we will update you on the happenings in soccer.
They just showed a video because they have it like going right now in Times Square so everybody can watch. But I just feel like if you're driving, that's just going to distract you. Like, that's going to make traffic even worse.
I remember actually, I don't know which one it was. It might have been the women. But I think it might have been the... Maybe it was, I don't know. It was a few years ago. We were in New York City, and we snuck into, not snuck into, but we popped into bar.
You're right the first time. You snuck in. It's cool.
We did pop into a bar. Now, it wasn't nuts, so I thought it would be a little crazier than it was. And it was cool to at least be in New York City and kind of the same thing. They were making a big deal about on the video screens. And so I love that. I like the fact that we can do that. I feel like the Olympics are less of that than they've ever been. It just, I don't know, it's because we dominate a lot of sports, or it feels like we do. We win a lot of medals. The Olympics are so long and stretched out, and it's like hours and hours and events and events. This is a little different, right? You've got two matches a week, essentially, and you can really rally around it. And it's also not like men and women. It's just like the Women's World Cup right now. Yeah. I know the Gold Cup's going on the men's side, but that's like totally secondary, at least here in the United States. The feel of it, in fact, men's soccer is secondary here in the United States.
Seems like
and it continues to be one of the fascinating things, probably something we don't talk about enough. But, I mean, it's like UConn women's basketball. UConn women's basketball is the biggest thing on that campus.
Yeah. I'll give that to you.
I think it's bigger than... Now, listen, they've won national titles, and so there have been stretches where the men's... But I know people that live near, in and around Storrs, Connecticut, and it is women's basketball. Like, they love women's basketball.
Well, and that's why they get all the recruits, because, I mean, you're going to play in that kind of environment, don't you?
Yeah, and Pat, now Pat Summitt, when she was at Tennessee, and obviously built Tennessee to this dynasty for so long... I think it was a big deal, and someone who went to Tennessee could probably tell me better, but I never got the feel that it was the biggest thing on campus. It was an important thing. It was a big thing. It was
cool.
But
you had college football,
though. But you have SEC football.
Yeah.
I mean, you had Peyton Manning as quarterback. You won a national title with T. Martin. You know, so it wasn't the biggest thing. UConn football is not bigger than women's basketball in Storrs, Connecticut. So it's very unusual. Like it or not, it's very unusual. And this is the case in the United States with soccer that, again, we do have it in the Olympics. But the Olympics is also, like, even soccer is on the radar more than just the World Cup times, I think. You do get big friendlies or you get these other matches that are happening. You know, if we talk about the other popular women's sports, gymnastics, figure skating, say in the Olympics,
yep,
that are bigger than the men's sports, mm-hmm, it's still every 4 years they're bigger. You know,
yeah,
it's one time every 4 years. Nobody knows what's happening in figure skating or gymnastics on the world's, you know, stage, mm-hmm, the other 3 years.
True.
You know? No, you're absolutely
right.
So nobody has a clue.
Yeah.
But in soccer, they kind of do. It's like these ladies, these players are stars, like, mm-hmm, even without the World Cup going on. It's not just like they're stars for 2 weeks. They're stars,
yep,
in the United States. So it's a fascinating dynamic because it is, bottom line, it's just unusual. This doesn't happen very often.
Without a doubt.
So maybe the United States will be balling in the second half and bring home a win 1-0 over France right now. How about some balling and falling right now?
How about a little social experiment today? Brent, I'm going to go with my homie, the underdog from the underground, Nate Lashley. Do you know who Nate Lashley is?
He is a golfer.
Nailed it. Okay, I think you're going to know who he is, and I have this big rant,
but never mind.
He's in third right now, but he's ranked 353rd in the world right now. He failed to qualify for the Rocket Mortgage Classic in Detroit, but he opted to stay in Detroit in hopes that he could be an alternate, and guess what? He became an alternate, and he shot 9-under yesterday for a 63, and after day one, he's the leader. Right now, he's in third. So, ballin', man. Like I said, the underdog from underground, Nate Lashley. And props to you for knowing who he was, because if you would have said you didn't know who he was, I had this big rant about how nobody cares about golf. But, hey, Brent saved the whole segment,
yeah,
man. I'm proud of you, Brent.
You're welcome,
I'm
golf.
Proud of you, man. Oh,
by the
Brent,
way,
I had it all written down. I was going to go on a tirade.
This is a good time to remind you that make sure you sign up for the Action Sports Shaq's Dream 18 Golf, yeah, Tournament, September 16th. You can go to Action Sports. SportsShackStream18.com. Very reasonable pricing. The golf club at Southampton will be our host, and we're going to have a lot of fun. In fact, I'm ordering some of the tea gifts like this afternoon and this evening, and we're getting ready to rock and roll for our 10th anniversary of the Action Sports Shack's Dream 18. So, speaking of golf, it's alive and well.
Oh, yes.
Lashley's invited.
Thriving.
If he wants to. Be, and you can be a part of it. All right, my balling, simply Javi Baez. And listen, we go a little over the top on localizing guys sometimes, and actually the golf world's probably a great example because we have so many guys that live in town now, that, yeah, even if they're not from here. And Javi Baez is not from Jacksonville. He played high school baseball at Arlington Country Day, but if I'm being honest, he never really felt like he was from Jacksonville. Yet, there's a little bit of an extension there. There's a local tie, and I'm a sucker for a local tie.
It's a
no
job.
Doubt about it. Yeah, it is my job. So there's always, and by the way, I believe, and some will say Ronald Acuna, but I think Javi Baez is the most electrifying player in the game. Now,
yeah,
Mike Trout's the best player in the game.
Yeah.
But when you talk electric, when you talk about a guy you want to watch, you want to watch a guy field a ground ball,
personality,
grab a tag,
as well.
Yeah,
mm-hmm,
run around the bases, swing and miss. I mean,
yeah,
Javi Baez makes swinging and missing cool.
Yeah.
I mean, he really does.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, he's going the All-Star game as a shortstop. He's a guy that's produced big time as a second baseman and now as a shortstop. And he's awesome. I mean,
yeah,
Baez, we knew it around here at the time, and there were whispers about how good this guy was and could be, and he's living up to it. You know, again, it's a long journey when you get drafted, like out of high school, you're 18, 19 years old, to make it to the bigs, but this journey has ended up right where so many people pegged Javi Baez to be. Baez will be a starter in the All-Star game in Cleveland in a couple of weeks, and well-earned. He's one of the most exciting players in the game.
He is. He's also a Cub, so I can't co-sign on,
yeah,
it, but I mean, you have to give credit where credit is due, so props to you, man. Congratulations. Fallen, Brent. What is this right here? What am I drawing right here?
Circle.
You better believe it, Brent, because this show is coming full circle. Bees have invaded the pitch at the Cricket World Cup in England, causing South Africa and Sri Lanka to hit the ground and literally lay on the ground for 30 minutes. They had to lay and try to take up as less space as possible while a swarm of bees invaded the pitch and try to sting them. So there you go, full circle. That's what I do here at ESPN 690. All right. Talk.
My fallen is I'm going to stick with baseball. It's that time of year. New York Mets. It's unbelievable. Did you see the stat?
I did. This was almost my fallen today, but I didn't want to get into all the analytics and everything. But it's bad.
I mean, they have blown multiple run leads 5 games in a row. And they did it in a sweep against the Phillies. Like, it was the first time the Phillies had accomplished such a feat of coming back like that and rallying and sweeping a team since, like, 1929 or something crazy. I mean, the numbers on this are ridiculous. But the Mets are a disaster in their bullpen. They seem to be a disaster overall. They had the whole Callaway and Reporter incident a couple days ago. They had to apologize for that. There's a lot going on with the New York Mets. It never seems to end. Despite Pete Alonso having an unbelievable year. So I say fallen is the New York Metropolitans.
Let me ask you this real quick. It just seems like a couple years ago the Mets went to the World Series, right?
A couple years ago?
Or was it they're in the playoffs? Weren't they in the World Series a couple years ago? The Mets?
Was it a couple years ago they were in?
I could have sworn.
Yes, they were. You're right.
Yeah,
you're
okay.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, it doesn't seem like a couple years ago.
Yeah.
It's probably like 4 now.
Okay.
5.
Okay, but my point is there any other sport where you can go from, and now this is going to be a Jaguars thing too, but is there any other sport where you can go from being on top for a season to just literally fall off the face of the earth the next season?
Well, like, I mean, football is probably the one.
Well, but I'm thinking the Marlins, Brent, the Florida Marlins, when they went to the World Series next year.
But it's like they almost tried on purpose to do it, though. You know, Marlins are a little different in that conversation because they kind of gut everybody.
Okay.
Or gut their roster.
Yeah.
And try to almost purge it. But, yeah, you know, what's interesting about the Mets is that they looked like they were on pace for a run for the next 3 years.
Exactly.
4 years, 5 years. They had all this young talent, all the arms.
Yeah.
And, well, what's happened to them? Well, most of the time they've gotten hurt. Mm-hmm. So they've had a string of really bad luck, too, with some of the injuries they've had. But you're right. It felt like they were on the escalator up. Because of this young talent they had on the mound, and bam, gone. So, but yes, it can happen in sports. All I have to do is take it to Jacksonville the last 2 years. But really, the NFL as a whole, you can do that in the NFL in a hurry, it seems like, right? You can go worst to first and first to worst, or at least close to, in the NFL like no other sport, probably.
And the last time the Mets were in the World Series, 2015, where they took on the Kansas City Royals. And obviously, they lost.
So what is that now? 4 years. I guess we're getting 4 years.
Yeah.
That time goes by fast.
Doesn't it?
Amazing. Especially on this show.
Oh, you're not lying.
It's time
man.
For another break.
Well, it's time for me to be in the parking lot pretty soon. Here,
yeah,
but
well, you've got a little
I'll
more
stick
time
around.
For that. Hope you're staying for Paul Posluszny's conversation.
I talked to Puzz, right?
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
That's up to him.
That's
Captain America.
Let me get to that topic I mentioned, loyalty in sports. Puzz seems like a loyal guy.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll give it to you.
How much loyalty is in sports because of free agency now? Where do we see it? Far few and far between examples of it. Does it matter to anybody?
I thought we were going to argue about this one.
We might.
I'd put a bet on it.
As long as you don't sing again.
Oh, you'd be surprised, man.
We'll be back on Action Sports Shacks on ESPN 690. If you want to jump in, star 690 is the number. Loyalty in sports, where do you think it sits?
Sports Jacks with Brent Martineau on ESPN 690 is brought to you by Best Bet Jacksonville and Orange Park.
I just don't know that there was a city that would be really excited about Rick Pitino. What has he accomplished in the pros that would suggest that it's worth taking on all of the baggage that he comes with?
The Dan Le Batard Show with Stu Gotts. Weekdays from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. on ESPN 690.
Right now at T-Mobile, get an awesome iPhone XR on us when you bring your family over and trade in your old device. Because whether you have mom, dad, or a friend on your mind, it's a gift so bold and brilliant, you'll want to keep it for yourself. Most importantly, it's on us in 6 vibrant colors. Plus, with unlimited everything from T-Mobile, the awesome iPhone XR will have everyone snapping, streaming, and sharing to their heart's content all year long. But don't wait. It's only for a limited time. So visit a store or call 1-800-T-Mobile and get iPhone XR on us.
Congested, customers using more than 50 gigs per month may notice reduced speeds due to prioritization. Video at 480p via 24 monthly bill credits for well-qualified customers plus tax. Qualifying trade-in, port-in, service, and finance agreement required. Contact us before canceling or credit stop and remaining balance due. 64 gigs, zero down, plus $31.25 per month for 24 months. Pre-credit price, $749.99, 0% APR, one offer per account.
4th of July is fast approaching, and you know what I heard? No, not fireworks. I heard that my friends over at Arlington Toyota are going to make your payments until after Labor Day. Free yourself from car payments this July 4th and buy a new Toyota from Arlington Toyota and make no payments until after Labor Day. During the Summer is on Us July 4th event, not only are you going to get a payment-free summer, you'll also get mind-blowing low pricing on 2019 Toyota models. This July 4th, drive away in a 2019 Corolla LE from Arlington as low as $13,881. That's a pre-owned 2019 Corolla for $13,881. Get 4th of July savings on a 2019 Camry LE starting at just $17,991. Yep, Arlington's got your pre-owned 2019 Camry for $17,991. Want a truck? Get a truck. As in 2019 Tacoma SR5 double cab from just $24,881. It's a pre-owned 2019 Tacoma for $24,881. It's the July 4th Summers on Us sales event, and it's going on now at Arlington Toyota. Sales is open all day on the 4th. Start shopping now at arlingtontoyota.com.
Okay, so my husband and I are different in that I do something cool, I want to tell every single person I know about it. I like to share the joy. He is a little more subdued, a little more private about it. I totally get it. But laser hair removal is one of those things that I know he's super jazzed about because it is so life-changing. By the way, Ideal Image Med Spa wants you to love the skin you're in this summer. Get 50% off laser hair removal. Students, teachers, school is out, and Ideal Image Med Spa is offering you additional discounts. Laser hair removal, let's talk about it. We all have embarrassing unwanted hair, and it's irritating. I know my husband really hated the razor bumps, hated wasting the time shaving, and the hair would grow right back. Call for your private complimentary consultation, 904-652-0652. That's 904-652-0652. Located at the Markets at Town Center, US 17, just south of Orange Park on Fleming Island, St. Augustine and Diane's Marketplace on South Ponce de Leon Boulevard. Medical Director, Dr. Holly Hickman, and Ideal Image.com.
Now, back to Action Sports Jax
on ESPN 690 and ESPN690.com.
Almost had a goal.
Yeah, France almost had one.
We don't like that.
Not one bit.
My buddy Scott Morlock up in Albany, New York says hockey has the best youth stars. Come on.
Austin Matthews.
Do you really feel that way?
Where's he from?
He's up in Albany. He's a big hockey guy.
Is he a big Buffalo?
He's a Red Wings fan.
Is he really?
Big Red Wings fan.
Funny, because I have a team next year that's, I might put some money down on to win the, or to go to the Stanley Cup, and they're the third to lead, they're like the third underdog right now.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Do you have a problem?
No.
Do you have a gambling problem?
No, I don't, man.
I'm talking a lot about these. Should we get you some help?
No, honestly, I'm not going to put any money down. But
we have a lot of significant programs here.
Just you wait till football starts up again.
I'm going to tell you right now, you heard it here first. The New York Rangers, I like them for the Stanley Cup next year.
Wow.
And they're the third least favored to win the Stanley Cup.
I just asked you the question that was my first ever question asked. It was very similar, at least, of Matt Jones when I got to Jacksonville.
What did you ask him?
Do you have a drug problem?
That was your first question?
Ever.
Hey,
yeah.
It's kind of aggressive, isn't
How's
it?
That
a
go?
Aggressive. I didn't go too well.
What was the response? Or you don't want to share it?
Nah, it wasn't actually vocal, but visually it was death stares.
Wait a minute.
He had just got popped for something again.
Yeah, but that's the that's the last thing someone wants to hear when they're down, you know, is, do you have a drug? I mean, I get it. You're doing your job as a journalist. I'm just saying.
I wasn't what the hell, man? Do you have a drug problem?
I'm just saying, being a professional athlete, Brent, you probably should have.
Well, listen, I knew that wasn't going to go too well. It probably would have been better if I'd been here a few years days or months before, or had met Matt Jones prior to that.
Well, it's a good thing Twitter wasn't around yet, because I'm sure you would have got a lot of love on Twitter.
I probably would have
went viral, and
who knows? It could have went either way, I guess. Could have been popular or unpopular.
But I do want to let you know, you know, this 25th season celebration, and I have nothing against Matt Jones. I just seriously asked the question, and I understand why that probably wasn't a good question on his part. But I highly doubt he even remembers the moment, although I remember it very well. We're right outside Jags headquarters. We tried to get a lot of different guys on this 25th season celebration. We've been in touch with some and then couldn't get them set up and scheduled. You know, we're doing around 5:30 most days here on Action Sports Jacks on ESPN 690. So it's not the easiest thing to track them down. But I did want to – we tried to get Matt Jones. I tried to at least reach out to him. There's some other guys like James Stewart. Couldn't track him down. We did the Gene Smith and Justin Blackman look. That was a short look. So there were guys like that, and I'm going to continue to try to track some of them down during this 25th season to celebration and kind of catch up, because I think it's been fun to hear from so many. And listen, sometimes the story's not always great, but I think people like to know what these folks are doing now, and that was part of the reason for the segment. We've had a lot of fun with it overall. Yesterday, Montel Owens, and today, Paul Posluszny will check in. So, and a lot of the folks that I put on my list, I will say, I put a question out about a month and a half ago on social media and asked who you wanted to hear from. And so we tried to get a lot of the guys that people wanted to hear from, and I think Posluszny was probably number one or two on the list of responses. And so it's cool. Pos will come on today, and we'll talk a little football, a little Jaguars football later on in the program. All right, loyalty in sports. NBA free agency about to hit. What, 200 players in the NBA are free agents, roughly?
40%. That's what Keith told us.
40% of the league.
Yeah.
That is astonishing. It just sounds like a big number.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. And so it's going to be a busy couple of days in NBA free agency. But does it exist anymore? There were days of Derek Jeter, Cal Ripken, Larry Bird, you name it. I mean, you can name Magic Johnson. You can, you know, all these guys. It just doesn't feel, one, as important, and maybe two, and most importantly, and this might be one instead of two, realistic anymore.
Yeah, I mean, I think you're absolutely right. I think in terms of just the high dollar contracts now, like, listen, like back in those days, I feel like, yeah, there were high contracts as well, but for the most part with the salary caps and everything, well, back then with baseball, I mean, was it really even a salary cap? I mean, there's still...
There isn't.
Yeah,
really.
But there's a tax. There's a luxury tax. Yeah. But I think that... I mean, how can I phrase this? I think that you had a little more room. So say if you're the Jaguars, you're trying to keep Ngakoue, you're trying to keep Miles Jack, and you're trying to keep Ramsey. I think you had a little more room to work with that as opposed to now, where you may not be able to keep those three guys just because the way that the salary cap has gone up, it's pretty much $10 million every single year. But, and we've talked about it before on the show, while it goes up $10 million on average a year for the salary cap, the contracts are getting more like, you know, $20 million more or $18 million more a year. So the salary cap doesn't fit the new contract. So with that being said, you know, you have to talk about loyalty. And I think it's loyalty is hurting because of that right there.
Yeah. And listen, there are things now. Like everything else, it seems to every day I say something and it seems to go back to branding. And so there are things now that impact players. Yes, it's money. Yes, it's salary cap. But yes, it's also marketability and branding. I mean, LeBron James is a great example of it. We all believe LeBron James went to L.A. because of Hollywood, because of Space Jam 2. You know, I mean, I still think it made no sense. I think it was a wrong decision. But I think there were other things in play other than playing basketball for the best place to play basketball and the best place to be. And I think he suffered the consequences of that last year to a degree.
And he also went to Miami to win a championship. I mean, this is a guy who grew up in Cleveland. One would have thought, like, I mean, listen, all the stars were aligned. He was the biggest thing ever to come out of high school. He played for the team that the city that he grew up in, and then he decided to leave to go play Miami and chase some championships. I mean, if anybody could talk about loyalty, it should have been LeBron James. Now, yes, LeBron James did come back, and he got the city of Cleveland a championship. But that wasn't guaranteed, though, either.
You know, I mean, who's to say if he didn't have a lot more success in Miami, maybe he would have stayed there with Bosh and Wade. Who knows? But I'm just saying, with loyalty, man, I mean, look no farther than LeBron James.
I think that's a great study in it, because I think that's why he went back to Cleveland. I think he felt bad about leaving Cleveland. I think loyalty pulled at him to go back to Cleveland.
We have two sides of it, right? So you have the side where LeBron left, and then you have the side of what we're dealing with right now with Kemba Walker. Kemba wanted to stay, and Michael Jordan and the Hornets offered him less than the max. So now he's like, well, if you're not going to offer me what I'm worth, I'm going to walk. And he's probably one of the last ones that you could say has been like a lifer for a team. I mean, you even had Tony Parker, who probably should have retired last year so that you could say he was just always on the Spurs. Well, now, you know, he did a year with the Hornets, and he's always going to have that now, where Kemba has still got a few years left, a few good years left, because he's going to get this max. But now it's probably not going to be with the Hornets, and you know, so that's not really on the player. You have, like, two different sides of it.
Quick little update. The women scored again, Megan Rapinoe, with her fifth goal in four games now for the USA. So they're up 2-0.
Is she going to the White House right after this match?
She will not be going to the White House, as she said.
I was killing me because I saw this about 30 seconds before, and I was like, I don't want to ruin it. I don't want to ruin.
Yeah, I guess we're on a delay here, Koo. Sorry.
So 2-0.
2-0. 2-0 for the USA.
That's a big lead.
Women's soccer team. Big lead. I love
it. Big lead for Team USA. We'll keep you posted on that. You know, again, we get the reasons for it. It's money.
Could analytics be a part of it as well?
Well, I think from an aging out standpoint, yeah. You know, so personally for me, there were a couple of different cases of this. I think Larry Bird was a big player in free agency in the NBA. I think there was a Larry Bird rule, and I honestly don't even know the ins and outs of it, but it was about him getting more money, and he kind of set he might not have been like the first person to do it, but it was a Larry Bird in the early 80s or mid 80s. Whatever happened with the Larry Bird rule to kind of that sparked a lot of the free agency stuff. Baseball has done it for like four decades now. So that kind of fits in the late 70s and early 80s. It was right around that time.
They let you're allowed to exceed your salary cap to re-sign their own players as free agents.
That was the Larry Bird rule?
Yeah, so you could essentially offer more. And you do have that, because that was what we were talking about with Durant and them. Like, the home team can always offer more than away teams, essentially.
There you go. So that triggered into the free agency talk. Yeah. I remember that being the case. And, you know, salary caps certainly weigh into it. But when does it tug at the strings of, hey, I want to be in this organization forever? We talked to Tampa Bay, Jenna Lane, this week, and Gerald McCoy. Mm. That whole situation with her information showed us that really it wasn't about money at the end of the day. It didn't seem like it was more about disconnect. But I mean, there was very little money difference between him and Ndamukong Suh, if I remember correctly. So yeah. I mean, it's not a lot of money difference. Where was the loyalty? And so that's the first question that always comes back. I'm not saying loyalty on the player all the time. Loyalty in the organization certainly exists. Now, dollars, age, common sense, that certainly plays into it. Sometimes you got to let a player go. I mean, you just got to let a guy go because he can't afford him. I mean, this organization might have to next year let Calais Campbell go. I mean, it's not because they don't want to keep him, but they just can't afford him at his age, potentially, to keep him.
Speaking of loyalty, and something that, you know, was in the headlines for a while with the Jacksonville Jaguars was Mercedes Lewis. He was a guy who, you know, came in with mojo back in the day. You know, was, you could say, loyal. He was a Pro Bowler for a season. Had some pretty good years in Jacksonville, and I get it. I mean, he might have been kind of towards the back nine of his career, if you will, when he was on his way out. But still, I mean, I think you could have got him for a pretty cheap deal, if you will. Ends up going to Green Bay then after it. But there's a guy, you talk about loyalty. I mean, that's a guy that did everything the right way, had zero problems or anything, was a great leader in that locker room. Probably could have used him, you know, when things went bad. But, so there's an example of loyalty as well.
I still love the player, right? Kobe Bryant fits in the player of the Lakers his whole career. You love the player that stays with the organization the whole way. I do. And that, I get it. That's an old school thing. I'm not taking anything away from him. We have these conversations sometimes. See, I do have a little bit of an issue with LeBron James. I would have been fine with a two-team LeBron James. I don't like the three-team LeBron James. I really don't. I would not have liked if Peyton Manning had gone to a third team to wrap up his career. There's just something that doesn't feel right. I wouldn't have liked that. But Peyton Manning, man, one of the greatest quarterbacks of all time, still went to another team. That shows you what happens. For me personally, it was Roger Clemens, Wade Boggs, Johnny Damon. Those guys ended up in freaking New York. I mean, if that didn't say loyalty was dead when a Red Sox player goes to New York, I mean, that was it for me. It's like, okay, well, this doesn't exist anymore. Mm-hmm. This doesn't it. It's not happening. As much as you love to see the Jeters who stay with the organization the whole way, are we even in, do we even have a guy that will stay with an organization the whole way in sports right now? Someone toward the end?
Well, Tom Brady's going to stay in New England.
Oh, yeah, Brady's the greatest.
Kemba's probably the one
Phillip
in NBA.
We have plenty of them, actually.
Plenty of them, yeah.
This free agency will decide
if Kemba...
Is Kemba
the only NBA guy? I mean, there's not another NBA guy that's been with the team the same the whole time.
Not that's older or, like, their star. At least nothing's ringing a bell.
I got nothing.
No, you're right. I mean, you
Wade,
think,
but even he left.
No, Wade
Dirk,
left.
So, Dirk, but he's retired Dirk. Now.
That's
but
a good example. That's probably the latest one.
Yeah.
It's a good call.
Yeah.
We'll read some of your comments about loyalty in sports and also who has the youngest collection of stars coming up. Plus, I've got a question for you. It's got to do with bars and sports. Oh, are we digging deep on a Friday? We might, but it's going to be fun. Next on ESPN 690.
Action Sports Jax with Brent Martineau. Weekdays from 3 to 6 p.m.
I had no idea we were going to draft Blaine Gabbert. All right. Did your jaw just drop?
Yeah, it did. Did you okay. Sense the silence?
No idea. In fact, I left to go get something to eat because our pick wasn't for much longer in the draft.
You're supposed to pick 16th, yeah.
On ESPN 690.
Hey, everybody, this is Brent Martineau along with Austin Lane. Leave your troubles ashore, live the island life with the citrus of the sea, Vida de Luis Tequila.
The new Vida de Luis Tequila is made from natural volcanic spring water.
It has no aldehydes. If you're wondering what aldehydes are, they are what cause the bad hangovers and headaches.
Vida de Luis is the smoothest tequila around. For location, recipes, and merchandise, visit VidaDeLuis.com.
Must be at least 21 to drink Vida de Luis. Find Vida de Luis in your favorite bars, restaurants, and liquor stores. Enjoy Vida de Luis. Responsibly.
Reason number 87 to choose Diamonds Direct over any other jeweler. Free service for life with no fine print. That's right. When you buy your engagement ring or any piece of jewelry at Diamonds Direct, you will never have to pay a dime in the future for sizing, cleaning, or routine maintenance. Even if she accidentally knocks out a side accent diamond, Diamonds Direct will replace it free. Now, other stores claim to offer warranties, but the catch is they won't honor it unless you bring your ring in for regular inspections. But at Diamonds Direct, inspections are never required. There's no gotcha clause, no fine print, no looking for ways to void the warranty. Plain and simple, at Diamonds Direct, we stand behind what we sell, and we're committed to servicing it. At no charge, for life, period. It's all part of our commitment to provide you with the ultimate in value and total confidence. Diamonds Direct, the jeweler you can trust, with a no-questions-asked 100% free lifetime warranty. Come see us to learn more. At the Markets at Town Center, official jeweler of the Jaguars.
Join the city of Jacksonville and ESPN 690 as we celebrate our nation's independence with the annual 4th of July fireworks in downtown Jacksonville at Friendship Fountain. The fireworks will begin at 9:45 on July 4th. Visit specialevents.coj.net for more information.
Brent Martineau.
You see him every day on CBS 47, Fox 30, Action Sports Jax.
Austin Lane.
He's a former Jag star and current MMA fighter.
Broadcasting live from the Anna Jar and Levine Studio.
This is Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690 and ESPN690.com.
2-0 still, Team USA. That's the score. We've got some interaction on the social media front. Roethlisberger staying with the Steelers, says Submarine Mike. You're right. I think South Beach Gary just called in a couple of answers as well, and that was Steph Curry and maybe Klay Thompson. Is that what he said? Klay Thompson?
Westbrook.
Oh, Westbrook.
Well, Klay Thompson,
yeah, Russell
too, yeah.
Westbrook. Greg says sports are business, a job. People leave good jobs for better jobs, so there is no loyalty. Meta World Crazy, free agency, fantasy sports, and social media has changed it. Crash, Kurt, Flood helped change sports. Yes, Flood helped free agency. Agents helped destroy it. There's no more loyalty in sports, only in money and self. It is harder and harder to get the team concept, it feels like, with all the dollars and the branding and the things we talk about. And it's not on a player necessarily. It's just more the culture. It's more and harder than ever before, I think, in the sport of football, because we always talk about it. 53 players is a tough deal to get all on the same page. Back to a couple of other responses about baseball, football, basketball, which has the youngest stars. Someone did say golf. That was not an answer. Why do people like taking my multiple choice questions and then adding things to them? Like, I could have listed 500 sports.
Yeah. I mean, we could have listed snowboarding.
But
I
didn't.
Skateboarding.
I wanted to answer three of them.
Yes. The three major ones.
Come on, people. Jack Stan says there's only one correct answer here, baseball. John says, not sure how anyone couldn't vote for baseball besides them just not liking it. One needs to look no further than the age of the All-Stars. And that's really what brought this topic up, John. No such thing as a young football player. And Jack Stan also calling you out. Giannis was drafted in 2013.
Cool. He's also younger than Baker Mayfield and Carson Wentz.
What are we talking about? Oh, yeah, you just responded, I see.
Well, there you go, man. you want me to tell every time I tweet now?
No.
You want me to give you the rundown?
Oh, no, I was appreciative of your response.
Tonight, you know, when I'm tweeting at 11:30, I'm going to be sure to give you a heads up.
All right, if you were going to a bar, Kuz brought this up, so I'm gonna jump on it here.
I'm glad he's here to hear this.
And, of course, Kuz in a bar seems to be kind of...
Oh, man. Fish and water,
one of the
right?
same, right?
Yeah.
If you were going to go watch a sporting event, like today's soccer, if you're into it,
yeah,
Jags game.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Most people have Super Bowl parties. They don't. Do a lot of people go to bars and watch a Super Bowl?
I wouldn't. I mean, with all due respect.
Most people kind of, that's at your home or a cul-de-sac thing or a private party type of thing.
Yeah.
Isn't that funny?
It's a good point. I mean, but it's the whole, like, see, to me, it's about the food. I mean, yeah, you can go to a bar and get food, but why would I go to a bar and get food when I have like 20 guests bringing food for me?
Yeah.
So,
and you kind of want that.
It's a no-brainer.
You want that specialty dip, that taco dip.
Yeah.
Or buffalo chicken dip.
Exactly. But see, and with all the respect to Jacksonville, and we can get into different sports, but in terms of football, see, to me, it's different here in Jacksonville because a lot of people that live in Jacksonville are transplants. So, like, if you go to a bar on a Sunday, you may see, like, a bunch of, like, Steelers jerseys. You could see some Cowboys jerseys. Like, and I'm sure you can talk about New England, too, but if you go to a bar like in Wisconsin, I mean, you're going to see Packers jerseys. If you see a Bears jersey, you might get something said to you. But I feel like here it's a little more laid back and chill just because there are so many fans from different cities and whatnot.
Yeah, that makes sense. All right, so where do you go? Where have you gone to watch an event?
So honestly, the only events that I'll actually go out and watch are like UFC fights or boxing matches. And because usually, like, if I'm even like when the Brewers are doing their thing last year, and you have to remember, Brent, like, if I was in Wisconsin, it might be different, but like, I had nobody to go out and watch the Brewers with me last year.
Yeah, it's
like,
probably like, not a big crowd at whatever establishment watching the Brewers.
So I would just much rather watch it at home.
Well, what do people watch it? Soccer has become one of these things.
Soccer is one of those things, yeah.
I think you said fight night.
Oh, yeah, certainly. For sure, yeah. So, like, if we're talking about where I go watch a fight, right now I'm usually at the Ale House. The nice setup what they have was they have, like, couches and stuff outside, so you can actually sit outside on, like, and watch, like, on a big screen. So if I go to watch a fight, it's going to be the Ale House. But I have gone to Sneakers as well when they used to – we've been to, actually.
We did a show from there.
And I'm not sure if they actually show UFC fights anymore now. But that's a whole other topic for another time. Because, I mean, there's a reason why the pay-per-view model is dying, you know? Like, people aren't into going to watch fights anymore.
Well, expand on that, though, because we are talking on the topic.
Okay.
Well, what's interesting, I brought up Mr. Chubby's the other day as I was bragging about the wings.
Yeah.
Because I do like them. But they actually said it there. They have two locations.
Yeah.
And they stopped showing the fights at one location, I think is what the waitress said.
Yeah.
And then they brought them over to the other location.
Yeah.
But
I mean,
they did show it there. So on fight night on a Saturday night, they do really well, depending on what the card is and all that stuff.
Yeah. Well, and I've talked about it a little bit before, but we can dive back into it. And I'm going to talk about more of the UFC than boxing because it's pretty much the same thing. But with the UFC, you know, they signed the contract with ESPN, right? And that was when that happened, a lot of people were excited because ESPN is the biggest name in sports. But the problem with the ESPN contract is the fact that ESPN doesn't need MMA. With all due respect, because ESPN's going to be okay without
them. It's just
them.
In their portfolio. You know,
as opposed to Fox Sports, who didn't have a lot of the sports at their disposal, where the Fox Sports actually needed the UFC to be successful. So the UFC needs ESPN a lot more than ESPN needs UFC. So now, when you talk about that contract, because, and I've talked about it before on the show, where the UFC signed a contract where all the pay-per-views will be off ESPN. So basically how that works is you have to buy the ESPN Plus app. And yeah, I know this is a long-winded thing. This is a lot of things you got to go to get a pay-per-view nowadays. You have to buy the ESPN Plus app, and then off there, you can purchase the pay-per-view. And in doing that, ESPN said, listen, we don't care about the analytics. We don't care about the numbers of what you guys are bringing to the table. We're just going to pay you like 300,000 pay-per-view buys for every pay-per-view. So basically that means it doesn't matter what kind of card you have, the UFC is making the same amount of money per pay-per-view. Now, that can be good and bad because now you don't have to tell the fighters' stories anymore, which is, I think, is a big part of fighting because you want to know who's actually going to be on the screen. You want to see the interviews. You want to see the stories behind, you know, the fighters. But they don't have to do that much anymore because they're making the same amount of money in the UFC every single pay-per-view. And another problem is the fact that the oversaturation of it. It used to be where there'd be a pay-per-view maybe every like once every 3 years, and like that pay-per-view was loaded. That card was stacked from top to bottom. I mean, you had to make it a priority. You were just counting down the days so you could go to a bar or if you wanted to spend like $60-$70 to watch this pay-per-view. It's not like that anymore. And, you know, I think Conor McGregor being quiet has something to do with it as well because Conor McGregor is the biggest face still in MMA. And the fact that I think the whole quote-unquote entertainment era is kind of coming to an end now because guys don't have to get on the microphone talk all this smack anymore. Guys don't have to go on Twitter talk all this smack anymore because you're going to make the same amount of money on a pay-per-view because that's the way it goes. You're not concerned about pay-per-view buys anymore as a fighter because either way you're getting the same amount of money.
By the way, France scored 2-1 now in that soccer match in mm-hmm. France. 2-1 United States leads. Well, how much time's left to say?
We're in the 81th. What, the 81th? We're in the 81st minute.
Well, and you're behind, so it's probably like in the 84th 83rd, minute.
Yeah. 83rd. Oh, dang, come on.
83rd minute,
2-1. PlayStation View, step your game up.
United States is in the lead for now. Did I just see something?
Hold on.
Break on Twitter?
Don't you?
No, you're good.
Okay. There's a lot of swearing going on Twitter right now. So
Unless I'm behind.
We'll see.
But they just no.
The question is, so where do you go and watch a sporting event? And really, there's not a ton of sporting events that you go to, I think. And now listen, I think because of fantasy football, the NFL ticket, if you don't purchase it, you go to a restaurant, you can watch that. First Coast Bubbler says for NFL, I usually do Timeout Grill. Yeah. I've seen some of the soccer before at like some of the Irish pubs like Culhane's or Lynch's, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, that's where you get a big crowd going there.
Now, I had been a timeout to watch the NCAA tournament.
NCAA tournament's a good watch one, right?
Yeah, I mean, that's a fantastic one, yeah.
Ale House is a place with all TVs. I mean, you just think big TVs, and you can go. But and now there's, I think, a lot of the breweries that are popping up, places like that. So there's I just talked about it yesterday. There's so many restaurants that went down. You can probably go to a million different places and check it out. So we'll see. Get your thoughts on it if you want. Star 690. Where do you go? Which bar to watch a sporting event if you go out like that and check it out, an event like today's soccer match? You, by the way, have an opponent, speaking of fights.
I do.
I saw you announce that today.
Yep.
Don't bury the lead, man. Sometimes you got to remind me. I forget about these things. Good, I got a lot going on.
It's all good, man.
July 20th in Tallahassee.
Yes, sir.
What do you know about your opponent? Don't give too much away now.
Cameron Graham. I mean, not much to give away. The dude's going to come to bang. He's a heavy hitter. He goes for the knockout. He's got a good overhand right. Has an okay kick set up, but, I mean, he's going to try to knock me out with the overhand right. That's what we're practicing right
now. Looks like a big guy.
Bigger dude, yeah. I mean, I think he might have to cut a little bit to get to 65.
Really?
He's about 6'1". They say a 77 or 78-inch reach. You can't really go by what they say. But,
is that big reach?
I got like an 81, so it's, okay. Yeah. I mean, smaller than me.
Not bad for 6'1", but you're 6'6".
Not bad for
6'1",
yeah. Exactly.
Yeah, so you'll get him on the reach. Reach is big.
Reach is huge, yeah.
I'd like to get out of the way of those things so you can't reach me.
Fair enough.
That's why I sit 84 inches away.
Yes, sir.
Hey, more to come. Stay in your lane included on Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690.
Bingo.
I'm not asking regular season or postseason. I'm asking the question, in the NBA, in the 2018-19 season, who was the most valuable player?
Well, again, it depends on your definition. Correct. Mine is different from the value thing when people try and say, well, take him off the team and the value. Giannis was the best player. So that's who I would have given it to. Kawhi Leonard was ungodly in the playoffs, but it's not a playoff award.
I mean, right now, if you're asking me for the entire NBA season, Kawhi was the MVP.
Golic and Wingo, weekday mornings at 6 Eastern on ESPN Radio and ESPN2.
Hey, everybody, this is Brent Martineau. If you've received a letter from the IRS and cannot pay them, things can get bad quickly. The IRS can seize your bank accounts and garnish your wages. If this is you, contact J. David Tax Law, a local firm right here in Jacksonville. Recently voted the best tax attorney in Jacksonville by Folio Weekly Readers and selected as an ultimate tax attorney by the Jacksonville Business Journal. Your first step to stop IRS harassment is a no-cost consultation. They explain exactly your options and how they'll resolve your tax issue. Only trust an experienced and award-winning tax firm to represent you. The fastest way to get started is to call 904-507-4777. Peace of mind is only a click or phone call away, also online at jdavidtaxlaw.com. Only trust an experienced and award-winning tax firm to represent you by calling this number again, 904-507-4777, or online at jdavidtaxlaw.com.
When the time comes to get your roof replaced, call Big Fish Roofing. We don't require any upfront deposits, and we are locally owned and operated by Jacksonville natives who have built their business on quality and integrity. At Big Fish Roofing, we know your roof is the first line of defense against the elements, so we make sure to deliver a quality project in a timely manner. You can find us at bigfishroofing.com or facebook.com/bigfishroofing, or give us a call at 904-685-8334.
Brian was 14 years old when the power at home was turned off for good. He was bullied at school because his clothes weren't clean and his hair wasn't washed. He felt alone until he connected with a communities and schools site coordinator. Today, Brian is happily preparing for graduation with his friends. Communities and Schools of Jacksonville has been helping students stay on the path to graduation for 30 years. Our staff works within the schools to empower at-risk students so they can overcome obstacles and achieve in life. Support student success at cisjax.org.
Hi, I'm Jalen Ramsey, here to tell you a little about Nimnik Chevrolet, the 2018 Dealer of the Year. Every month is military appreciation at Nimnik Chevrolet. Nimnik is proud to provide military members and first responders exceptional discount programs all year long. Nimnik Chevrolet also has the largest inventory of new Chevys in the region. This means they have the color and trim you are looking for with the best price guarantee. Visit us at NimnikChevy.com. Nimnik Chevrolet, Chevy, find new roads.
Hey, everybody, this is Brent Martineau from Action Sports Jacks on ESPN 690. Make sure when you're running out to the grocery store or back home from church, you check out some baseball on Sunday morning right here on ESPN 690. Listen on the radio to the Red Sox and Yankees London Series from across the pond.
Hey, it's Mike Golic from Golic and Wingo. You're listening to Action Sports Jacks with our friend Brent Martineau on ESPN 690.
What you got? You getting nervous over there? 2-1. United States and France. Sounds like there's going to be a lot of stoppage time, too.
I'm starting to stress eat over here. Yeah, I'm kind of nervous.
Can't blow a two-goal lead.
You sure can.
That'd be disastrous.
Yeah. Ooh, we'll see, man.
Don't let it happen.
Nope.
This is up to you.
Well, and it bothers me because Kuz knows what's happening before I do, because he's up like 2 minutes than I am.
I know. I'm trying not to give anything away to you.
I'm just trying to watch your facial reactions. I mean, it's, when it comes to poker face, not sure if you have a good one.
How much time is left on your clock?
They're about to hit the 90th minute right now.
Okay, so there'll be extra time. I hear there's a decent amount of extra time, too, so we'll see what happens. My TV, it's a little unclear right now, so I can't really tell what it says. Thanks for chipping in on the information, Coos. hey.
5 minutes.
We should be paying attention to Mike Trout a little bit more than we are.
It's hard, Brent.
Somebody said, I think it was Tim Kirkshen.
Tim Kirkshen?
Last night. Your guy.
Yeah.
I think he said yesterday, he said, it's like Mickey Mantle has been reincarnated.
Yeah.
I mean, he is, they are, you saw the tweet, I think Buster Olney had the tweet last week. It was the numbers of Trout versus Mantle, mm-hmm. and they were similar. Mantle's actually a better
I thought when he tweeted it, when I first saw it, it was going to be Trout's were even better, but it's actually Mantle's were better. See, Mickey Mantle to me helps that whole 1940s, 1950s, I want to see baseball go back to that era, because where I grew up, there were a lot of Red Sox fans, of course, but there are also a lot of Yankees fans, a lot of Italians that loved Joe DiMaggio, mm-hmm. but that fell in love with the Yankees and loved Mickey Mantle. Even in my family, like cousins and uncles, they loved Mickey Mantle. And, I mean, they talked about Mickey Mantle like you name your most famous, precious athlete of all time, and that's what they refer to Mickey Mantle. So I always, there was always this aura for me around the name Mickey Mantle, mm-hmm. even though I was like, okay, I've never seen him play. You know,
yeah.
I don't know much about him. But when you start comparing people to Mickey Mantle, it resonates. You know, Tony Gwynn, from a hitting standpoint, you could compare to Ted Williams in terms of how good of a hitter he was. But, you know, even Ted Williams, he goes down as probably the greatest hitter of all time, in my opinion. Yet he doesn't come with the aura of a Mickey Mantle. You know, it's just something different. And when you bring that name up and you say Mike Trout's that guy, and then in the All-Star show last night, they asked players, who's your favorite player to watch? And it was Mickey Mantle. I'm sorry, Trout. Every guy in the league said if you could watch one player play the game, Trout. They even said to the point it was cliche that it's Trout, but it's still Trout. It's like everybody's going to say this, but it's still Trout. They like stop in their tracks to watch Mike Trout play baseball. We are not appreciating one of the best athletes to play the game of baseball, who will go down as one of the greatest baseball players of all time. We are not appreciating him enough right now as sports fans. We just aren't. I mean, we are missing it. Like, we are appreciating Tom Brady. Mm-hmm. We appreciated Michael Jordan. We appreciate LeBron James. We can debate back and forth who's better, but we are absorbing it all. And we, by the way, Tiger Woods, same thing, fits the category. We soak it in, man. Whether you love him or hate him or whatever, you watch it. You absorb it. You can tell the stories. I saw this shot. I saw this. I saw that. We can't say that about Mike Trout, but he belongs in the category of all those, most likely.
He does, but, and here's, listen, I mean, without a doubt, Mike Trout is a special talent, okay? The fact that he plays in the West Coast has a lot to do with it.
Absolutely.
Okay? I mean, there was a reason when Marcus Mariota won the Heisman Trophy, I had no idea who he was, going to be honest with you. Didn't watch a lot of Oregon football, didn't watch a lot of Pac-10 at the time after dark. Just didn't do that. But the thing with Trout that's interesting to me, so he gets called up in 2011, immediately wins Rookie of the Year, 8-time All-Star. But is it kind of shocking you that he's only won 2 MVP awards for as much as he's been able to produce? Because you look at a guy like Barry Bonds. Barry Bonds won the MVP, and now granted, yes, steroids were probably a part of it.
Is he 6 times?
Well, he won it 4 times in a row.
4 in a row.
Yeah. You got a guy like Pujols.
By the way, I think he won times. Those. I would keep, he won a lot of those MVPs before the roids.
Well, of course. So 90s. Then he also won one in 90 and then 92 as well, 93. But then he hit the string where it was 2001, 2002, 2003, 2004.
He was 4 times in that stretch. So he won 7 MVPs?
There you go.
I did not realize that.
Yeah. So
I thought it was 6.
Yeah. And then you got a guy like, I mean, I'm just looking at the list here. I mean, Miguel Cabrera goes back-to-back 2011-2012 with Detroit, you know? So, and Trout hasn't done that yet. And it's crazy for, as much as we tout Mike Trout as being just like this once-in-a-lifetime kind of guy, I mean, where are the awards to back it up, Brent?
Well, yeah, it's good. The numbers are there. And I think part of it is it's kind of like the NBA.
Is it kind of like the team success is
LeBron
dictated
James,
on it?
We get tired of the winner, although I don't know if Mike Trout won it enough to get tired of him. Mm-hmm. Mookie Betts, well-deserving, right?
Yeah.
Miguel Cabrera's an unbelievable hitter. I mean, he was well-deserving. He won Triple Crown one of those years. He had to win it. So we've seen great baseball performances. I'm sure, has one of the Houston Astros won it? Was Altuve an MVP or one of those guys in recent memory? I'm thinking he might have been.
He was Altuve was 2017.
Yeah. So those guys are well-deserved MVPs. But in totality, day in, day out, game in, game out, this guy gets it done. And it's really the story here is we all know this. I think it's been said enough. But I think it's a reminder, and this is a good time to watch. There's not a lot of other sports going on. This is a good time for baseball, right? You have your All-Star game coming up. It's kind of the Midsummer Classic is a big thing. You got July 4th. It feels like baseball time. Turn the TV on and try to find Mike Trout and watch him play.
Yeah.
Because we're missing a guy in his prime that is one of the all-timers. He is 10 times better than Bryce Harper. Yet Bryce Harper gets a lot of the love because outgoing personality, the big beard, big contract in Philadelphia. No, this guy's a way better player than Bryce Harper, and I like Bryce Harper.
Mm-hmm.
But this guy gets it done all the time from at the field, stealing bases. He's a freight train. I mean, he's a football player playing baseball. How many of them are there really in Major League Baseball right now? There's Aaron Judge. There's Giancarlo Stanton that look like tight ends.
Yeah.
And by the way, Stanton was a tight end. Stanton had like USC offers to play tight end.
Yeah. I think Pujols back in his prime was kind of
that way.
Felt that way. I mean, he's still a big dude.
But think about Pujols. Let me just say this about Pujols.
Sure.
It feels like the other guys can do this even more than Pujols. Maybe they can't, but it feels like in my mind that they can run. Like Pujols never could run.
No, I got you. Know? Yeah.
Like Pujols, you might have to line him up as a blocking
tight
end.
I'm talking about like physique. Yeah, I got you. Man.
There's not a lot of them.
No, for sure. Maybe, I mean, is Vlad Guerrero Jr., is he pretty big?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. No, that's a good call.
Put it on him.
And he's so young. Like, Fernando Tatis Jr. maybe is another one. Yeah. Like, those guys are so young. We haven't seen enough of them. But Trout, like, I feel like Trout in football, you could put at tight end. I feel like you could put him at linebacker, maybe even strong safety. You might even put him in the backfield running back or fullback.
Yeah.
I mean, he is that kind of athlete, man.
Mm-hmm.
And, I moral of the story here is I just don't know if we're enjoying him enough. And it hit me last night watching everybody else talk about him. All these other players, there's no better compliment than what your peers say about you. And
of
when
course.
You have that many guys, all the stars in baseball, they were asked that question. And I'm telling you, I think I might have heard another name like once or twice, but it was all Trout.
Mm-hmm.
And it just really stuck out to me. Like, man, we got to watch him. I've got to watch him more. I'm a baseball fan, but I need to turn my TV on and watch Mike Trout more. I need to be able to say that I watched him, and I watched him more than once on a Fox Saturday or once in an All-Star game.
Brent, to be fair, I mean, unless it's away games, no one's tuning in at, 10:30 with all due respect to watch baseball. I mean, unless you're a fan of the team, no
it's
casual baseball fan's going to do that.
Yeah, it's hard to do.
Especially on the East Coast.
I will say this. At work last night, I watched on TV while I was doing some other things, watched Colorado and the Dodgers.
Okay.
That was an entertaining game.
Sure.
It was back and forth, back and forth, and the Dodgers end up winning again. Dodgers are awesome.
Dodgers
man.
Are good. And good. I didn't even have them going to the playoffs this year. We did like our MLB predictions.
You tried to get them in the upset.
But yeah, yeah.
Didn't happen.
No.
Hey, did you see the Rays the Rays are trying to sell tickets for like $2 now and peanuts for $2. And the story here for me is this is a little bit, they tried for the $5 thing a few weeks back, didn't sell it out. I think they're trying to see the results here and say, hey, we want you to come to the games. We want you to do it.
Our team is good, by the way.
Yeah.
You know?
Come to the games. But there's a backside of this. The owner, who obviously has been in the public the last week or so with this whole Montreal thing and it's not going to work in Tampa thing, not 81 times. I think if they don't show up next week at $2 a pop, you can't get into anywhere for $2.
Over like a holiday week, too.
Yeah. I mean, if you say, well, we only put 18,000 in, we couldn't even fill the stadium halfway in this.
Yeah.
It's another kind of thing in their back pocket that they can say, see, it just can't work here. So I think there's motivation in that to say, all right, let's try this experiment.
Well, and props to the Rays for trying to do everything in their power to try to make this work. It's like a relationship, but the fans don't want to cooperate, man. So maybe you don't earn a baseball
team.
Well,
now they've pissed the fans off a little bit with this whole Montreal thing, too. There is that part of it. Jawaan Taylor conversation. Paul Posluszny on the way in the 5 o'clock hour as well.
Join ESPN 690 at the River City Wrestling Con from 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. this Saturday, June 29th at the Jacksonville Fairgrounds, featuring Kevin Nash, Scott Hall, Arn Anderson, and a special interview with Ricky the Dragon Steamboat.
Cloudhesive and Amazon Web Services present to you the 2019 Tech Coast Conference in association with the Jax IT Council and your Jax Chamber. The Tech Coast Conference is a showcase of technology, innovation, and cutting-edge trends featuring innovators from around the world. The Tech Coast Conference is beyond anything ever before seen on the First Coast. Tickets and sponsorships are available now at techcoastconference.com. Don't let your knowledge or business be left in the dark ages. Secure your spot in the Tech Coast Conference today.
Celebrate sizzling Sprint weekend with amazing savings at your local Sprint store June 28th, 29th, and 30th. Now for a limited time, when you switch to Sprint, we'll cover your switching fees up to $650 per line with a prepaid MasterCard. That's right, up to $650 per line. It's our way of giving you a clean slate so you can make the switch to Sprint. Plus, this weekend only, when you switch to Sprint, you'll get $100 via prepaid MasterCard for each new phone you lease. The more lines you switch, the more savings you'll get. There's never been a better time to switch to Sprint. Stop by your local Sprint store during Sizzling Sprint Weekend, June 28th, 29th, and 30th to learn more and check out other great deals. Less required phone trading, credit provided, online registration, and new phone activation. Amount based on early termination fee charge or remaining phone balance. Requires port, online registration, and 60 days of service before card ships. Card terms, conditions, and exclusions apply. Member FDIC.
Broadcasting live from the ESPN 690 Anna Jar and Levine Studios. Anna Jar and Levine Accident Attorneys. Call 904-600-4000. That's 904-600-4000. ESPN 690. Jacksonville's home for ESPN Radio.
Hey, it's Trey Wingo from Golic and Wingo, and you're listening to ESPN 690.
WOKV Jacksonville. Listen live everywhere you go on ESPN690.com. ESPN 690, a Cox Media Group station.
ESPN Radio Sports Center.
I'm Doug Brown. Team USA beats France 2-1 at the Women's World Cup quarterfinals in Paris. Even though they were outplayed for much of the second half, Megan Rapinoe, for the second straight game, scores both U.S. goals. The Americans will now play England in the semifinals on Tuesday. ESPN's Adrian Wojnarowski reports the Warriors plan to offer Klay Thompson a five-year, $190 million max contract when free agency starts on Sunday. The Warriors today extend the contracts of GM Bob Myers and COO Rick Welts. The Lakers could be planning to make a run at Kawhi Leonard to team him with LeBron James and Anthony Davis. Here's Wojnarowski.
It would be the biggest big three, maybe of all. Listen, the pitch the Lakers have to make to Kawhi Leonard is what's authentic to them, and that's LA. The Lakers are the team of stars.
The free agent signing period starts at 6 p.m. Eastern Sunday. Wimbledon tennis opens Monday. After today's draw, the top seed Roger Federer, the two seed rather, and the three seed Rafa Nadal could meet in the semis.
Why pay twice as much for your wireless when you can get the same 4G LTE networks for up to half the cost? For $45 a month, get our unlimited plan with 25 gigs of data from Straight Talk Wireless. Only at Walmart. Savings may vary. See terms and conditions at straighttalk.com.
Brent Martineau.
You see him every day on CBS 47, Fox 30, Action Sports Jax.
Austin Lane.
He's a former Jag star and current MMA fighter.
Broadcasting live from the Anna Jar and Levine Studio.
This is Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690 and ESPN690.com.
The United States did it. They hang on. 2-1 over France. Moving on to the semifinals now. Now you got to guard against a little bit of a letdown, though, right? Because this was, like, so amped up for this game, this match. And so France, the team to beat on their home turf, got it done.
Playing England.
Human instinct.
Playing England next.
Is just to let your foot off the gas a little bit. Don't do it, ladies.
Oh, never.
When's the match against England, did it say?
It's a great question.
Out here.
I don't think it's been announced yet.
Come on, still Tuesday.
There's still some quarter.
Don't worry, people, I'll fill you in.
Well, then why would you even ask me the question, dude?
Well, because I was just giving you a chance to do something.
Way to put me on the spot. I said they're playing England.
You did have England.
I'll give you that. Told me that, but yeah.
And you call yourself a fan.
Whatever, man. I was
surprised you didn't know the whole bracket.
I know that Norway got beat, and I was kind of bummed about that.
But. Well, now all the fake women's soccer fans can return to their normally scheduled programming for the next few days until Tuesday hits against England.
Did you know that Norway has probably the best player in the country, and she didn't play?
In the world?
Yeah. And then I'm sorry, in the world. Yeah, my bad. And didn't play.
Why not?
I guess disputes with payment and everything like that.
Really?
Yeah. So she took a stand.
Huh. So it's not just the United States doing this.
Oh, no. Dude, I talked about the German commercial. From Germany. And I think they're playing pretty soon coming up here, too.
I feel like the United States on the forefront of it. Of course, because we live here.
That's because we live here. But I think it's kind of a thing all around the world.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
So she's supposed to be the best player in the world. And
She sat out.
That's a pretty good protest.
Yes, sir.
Brent Martin of Austin.
I'm thinking
Lane.
About sitting out too pretty soon.
I kind of feel like you have been.
I'm here, man. I'm here in full effect. I'm just waiting for Puzz to get on the horn.
Yeah, Puzz coming up in about 20 minutes. We'll talk to Jawaan Taylor in just a little bit as well. Stay in your lane coming up. And I do want to mention a thought or two about the netting going up in Major League Baseball parks and that story that has become very topical around Major League Baseball as well. But right now, Friday edition, in honor of the United States women's team getting a big win at the World Cup 2-1. In honor of heading into the weekend. In honor of heading into a little vacation. How about we hit the happy hour horn?
Grab a drink, get a shot, tip your star tenders, and grab a win.
Got a W.
A dub.
You haven't done like an impersonation on the Vita de Louis Happy Hour horn in quite a while.
That's because I spent up all my talents singing the Julius Randle song yesterday.
Yes, that was good.
Thank you very much.
Very good.
Yes.
Wink, wink. Locally owned tequila right here in Jacksonville, made in Tequila, Mexico, shipped directly to Jack's Beach. Make your own recipes with Vita de Louis Tequila, one of the smoothest tequilas you'll ever taste. For locations, recipes, and merchandise, visit VitaDeLouis.com. Drink responsibly. July 4th plans. You guys have anything? And you got to be low key because you got the fight coming up in just a few weeks.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Can't be having some barley pops and some hot dogs, man. You got to keep it under wraps. So I think we'll probably just go to one of our friends' houses at the beach, watch some fireworks at night, and then call it a day. Pretty low key for the Lane family. What about you?
We'll be on a cruise.
You'll be on a cruise?
Somewhere. Probably not even in the United States.
I was going to say, are you going to be in a country that celebrates the 4th of July?
Who thought of this?
Yeah, man.
Is that not right?
You're not going to celebrate the 4th of July.
Well, I don't know. I might be. I don't know. I mean, what's do we like own some of these islands that I'm heading to?
You're asking the wrong dude, man. You're absolutely asking the wrong dude.
I don't even know where I'm going. I don't know. I haven't even asked.
You're just going to know when you get there, right?
Yeah, I have no idea.
Yeah.
I couldn't tell you. I could guess. I think I know a couple of them, but yeah. That's a good call. I'm not sure if they are American properties.
Well,
who the heck planned this thing?
I'm looking at you, dude. Was this you or Mrs. Martineau, the Hall of Famer?
Oh, yeah, it's the Hall of Famer.
Okay, well, she can
Hall
do what she wants.
Hall of Fame travel agent.
Yeah, I hear you.
You do have announced today, by the way, fight opponent for Austin Lane coming up in Tallahassee July 20th.
Yes.
Get a little watch party out there.
Maybe a little bit, you know. Is there not a football game yet, unfortunately. Not in July. Yeah, that'd be something to do.
July 20th, it will take place late on a Saturday night, probably similar to what happened here.
That is correct.
I'll have to put that in the works, Coos. Once you get that going. Coos, you going to go? Tallahassee?
It's a drive.
Oh, maybe.
That's definitely a no.
Yeah,
it's all right, man. You don't have to lie.
Well, it just depends on what's going on. If I have to work on the weekend, you know.
Yeah, you're all good, man. You don't got to lie to me.
Here's the thing. I had so much more fun than I thought I was going to have at the last one I went.
I'm glad you did.
Combat night, that was awesome. I had a great time.
And Ivan came through the crowd to say what's up to you, and you left already. But it's all good, though, man. Yeah, it's
that's
good.
Because here's the thing. I came from TPC Sawgrass.
No, I understand.
I was struggling, and there wasn't any food. All the pulled pork was gone. So
true that.
I was running on fumes.
No, you're all good, man. No worries.
That was a quick exit. by Kuz.
Yep, get in, get out.
I got okay. in, got out. I
got the footage and
got yeah. in, got out, went right over to see Senors and got some tacos.
Business for the businessman. You got to respect it.
Yeah, absolutely. So, well, once again, the opponent is?
His name is Cam Graham.
Cam Graham, and that will be July 20th.
That is correct. For combat night.
In Tallahassee.
Yes.
All right, we'll see what we can do. We got to try to get out there. I know Ty has a tournament that weekend, but we'll have to see what's happening.
A baseball tournament?
Yeah.
Color me shocked.
Yeah, I know it. It's actually like the last one.
Is there going to be a baseball tournament on this cruise you guys are coming up to? is this some kind of like Little League cruise you guys are taking or what?
That's a good idea.
Yeah, there you go.
Play a baseball game on a cruise.
Yeah, you never know. I don't know how you Little League dads are. I have no idea.
There's a possibility that does exist. Speaking of baseball, one more thought on baseball. The netting in Major League Baseball. And it is now happening. Everybody's going to do it. Good idea. Long overdue. What took so long? What's the thoughts on the netting? Especially after all these incidents, the most recent one with a 2-year-old and
that's
fractured
horrible.
Skull.
Yeah.
How many did you say have been hit this year by foul balls? Did you say 18?
I don't think that someone told us that yesterday though.
Oh, okay.
But I don't know.
You just made up a number.
24.
24. Obviously, I think it's a good idea, Brent, and I'm not sure what has taken so long. I really wonder, and I don't. People take this the wrong way, especially with the little girl who's got hit. You know, she had the fractured skull. I think thankfully she's gonna make a full recovery. Correct? Of what I read.
I didn't see too much on the information. I saw that they came out and talked about it.
Yeah.
And by the way, like, there are more teams doing it. The Nationals, I think, are the latest team to do it. I think there might even be a couple of other ones doing it. But this latest story is more that even the United States senators are telling Major League Baseball that they should be proactive in getting the protective netting. I mean, the bottom line here is we're going to get to that point.
But I'm saying
where they all get done. I mean, now we're starting to see it.
Do you think the reason why it has taken this long is for the fact that nowadays it seems like everyone's on their cell phone during a baseball game and maybe watching games at the top priority?
Yeah, I do. I think so. I think I think that's the easy answer is that we're distracted.
Yeah.
Right. We have short attention span, so we're talking to the people next to us. We're talking on the phones. Yeah, we're tweeting. We're Facebook. We're taking pictures.
And I don't
want to
get taken the wrong way because the 2-year-old wasn't on a cell phone. You know,
no.
she was an innocent bystander. So that's not always the case, obviously.
Yeah, I think it's tough to blanket it. You know, it's like that is a big reason why. But in this all or nothing society we live in, to say it's got to be this or it's going to be this way,
answer.
I don't think that's the only answer. I think some of the answer is bigger, faster, stronger. I mean, you have guys throwing 100 miles an hour, a lot more people throwing 100 miles per hour, some throwing 103, 104 miles per hour, which means the exit velocities and everything else are coming off that bat a lot quicker. So you just think of it. If you're late on a pitch, well, that's the one that's going, say you're a right-handed batter and you're late on a pitch, that's one going down the first base line and that thing's cruising down the first base line. That's that low line drive or a one hopper into the stands. That's the one where everybody already goes, oh, I don't want to touch that one.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Well, that's going into a mass of people at whatever rate of speed that is. And that's always happened. But now the fact that you're probably more late on fastballs than you've ever been before because the pitchers are throwing 102 more consistently and you're seeing more fresh arms coming out of the bullpen. So you can really track it all the way back down to that. And so I think it is a... Yes, I think people aren't paying attention. Yes, I think phones are a part of it, and we're distracted partly because of that, but partly because we just don't want to sit still for 3 hours in any given time. But I do think the bigger, faster, stronger part of this is the real deal, too. I think that's essentially a major part of why balls are coming off the bat so quickly and why maybe there are even, I don't know about more foul balls, but harder foul balls down the line.
This is a little off topic, but it's kind of the same discussion. For bullpens now, are all the bullpens in outfield or do they still do the bullpen yeah, towards like the side.
That's a good question. I feel like I've seen that in major leagues where there still are some that are out in play.
I mean, but I has there ever been an accident with that either? Because I remember
what usually happens is you have a. Has there ever been? Probably.
Yeah.
I don't think you hear a lot about it, but what usually happens is there's an extra body to protect the pitcher, mm-hmm. you know, who's watching that, almost like the ball girl or ball boy.
Yeah.
But they usually put a player out there. So to your point, I want to say that all major league parks have the bullpen that's enclosed.
Okay.
But the baseball grounds, which is a fantastic facility right here at Bregan Field, they have the bullpen that is open.
Yeah, I could have sworn a couple stadium. Maybe that's changed now in the past, you know, 5 years. But I could have swore a couple years ago there was some open bullpens. But maybe some research to do. But, yeah, I mean, same thing with that, too, as well. I remember being in high school, and I was, like, a backup catcher, so I had to get the pitchers ready. And there was an open bullpen for us, and I had my back turned, you know, to the game. And that always made me a little nervous as well. But the point is, listen, like, when it comes to the netting, of course you should put the net up all the way around. I mean, why wouldn't you? It's not like... I mean, the only argument you could say is like, well, the view could be obstructed a little bit. Yeah. But, I mean, that...
I think people
really
are getting
though?
Used to that. Yeah. I think people now understand. I mean, you know, you are paying a lot for a ticket, so you should maybe get to at your own risk. But, you know, you pay a lot for a ticket, and they still cut off beer sales in the seventh inning.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Because they're trying to help and protect people, too, in that regard. That's why they do it. It's not because they don't want to make any more money, but they don't want people walking out of there drunk, at, you know, in the ninth inning right when the game ends and potentially getting in a car and all that. That's why they shut it down earlier in the baseball game. The other part of this story, though, is... should politicians be able to dictate? Like, there's a couple of senators there that are urging this. Again, I think we're going this way anyway. I don't know if it needs urging by politicians, but I guess a small part of the story is, should they be involved in it? Like, I mean, should Major League Baseball have to listen to that? You know, in a sense, they're, I guess, trying to protect their constituents in a roundabout way. But I don't really think it's the influence of U.S. senators that's going to change this or make this happen. I think it's what we've seen with that two-year-old girl. Yeah. I think it's the reaction we saw in that, what was the Cubs player, right?
Yes.
With the fan. Mm-hmm. I think it's those kind of incidents that open up Major League Baseball's eyes enough and say, let's do it. And I've told you this story before. We know somebody locally that does the netting, and sometimes at big ballparks, and he told me it's like $100,000 to do the netting. That is peanuts, man.
Yeah.
That's peanuts in big league baseball.
Yeah.
It's going to happen at some point. There is more netting up than ever before in most ballparks, including right here at the baseball grounds where the jumbo shrimp play.
Well,
but we are going to get to that
point.
And
if politicians have to get involved to make a change, then so be it, Brent, because you know what? It's
and there's an argument that politicians make change.
Well, they call it separation of church and state for a reason. It's not separation of church, state, and sports. You know what I'm saying? So,
Politicians have been involved in baseball before.
Oh, yeah, I hear you. So, I mean, if that's what it takes, then so be it. But as long as there's changes happening, I'm all for it.
Yeah, so it seems like... to me, the story is starting to get a little bit old on the netting.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, let's just do it. You know, let's do it. Let's make it happen.
What are you waiting for?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I think it would be I think all commissioners want to put their stamp on certain things. Rob Manfred is somewhat new to the commissioner office. I think he has a chance here to – I don't like what he's doing with the baseballs, to be quite honest with you. I don't know how much of that's his doing, but we talked about that the other day. I don't think the style of the game is in a great place right now in baseball. But I do think we could look back and say, well, Rob Manfred, while he was commissioner of baseball in the early years, put this netting up and protected people, and it saved whether it's lives or injuries or whatever else. Mm-hmm. And it made, you know what else does? It makes ballplayers feel more comfortable.
Yeah.
Because I don't want to know that I'm going to hit a rocket shot right at a fan and potentially hurt somebody.
You saw that reaction from that Cubs player.
Yeah.
I mean, it was horrible. I mean, the guy was in tears. You know, he was it was out of control. So, yeah, that helps players. It gives players a state of mind, the peace of mind as well.
Let's go back-to-back Jags right now. Paul Posluszny is going to join us in just a few minutes. But before we get there, Marcel Robinson caught up with Jaguars offensive tackle, rookie out of Florida, second-round pick Jawaan Taylor yesterday at the event with the Special Olympics at Jags headquarters. Here's Marcel's conversation with the big fella out of Gainesville.
My first question, why are you wearing a name badge when everyone here knows who you are?
You know, first impression, I just want people to know me. Like, even when we had our last player development thing we did, event, I put my Instagram on there. It's just like advertising, but Also Swagger, but we wore this. We had to put our names on the name tag in a meeting we just came from, so I just left it on there for the kids and stuff.
Now, speaking of the kids and stuff and making first impression, I'm pretty sure you made a very lasting one having fun with all these kids out here, man. Tell me how this event going. All you guys are smiling out here.
Oh, it's going great. We're enjoying ourselves. You know, getting to give back to the community. You know, we're role models for these kids. They look up there, so it's a lot of fun.
What does this do for you as players? Because like we said, all the kids are smiling, but every single player I see in here is smiling just as much, if not more, than all the, you know, participants.
It's great, you know, to get to see everybody smile, everyone having a good time. You know, we just want to give back to the community today and, you know, just do something great for the kids.
What's kind of the funnest moment that you've had out here today?
One kid just tried to call me out and tackle me, but, you know, I told him no. Because he was coming a little too hard. I ain't want to get ran over and get embarrassed out here today.
Well, we don't want to see you get ran over, and that's one of the reasons why we're getting started in about a month with that thing we call training camp, man. How excited are you, and can you be ready for training camp here?
Oh, yeah, I'm going to be ready to go. You know, I got to go home and, you know, work out, get ready to go, you know, come help this team win some games.
Now, throughout, you know, the rookie minicamp and the OTAs and the mandatory minicamp, you know, doing your offensive lineman work, it really doesn't start until you can kind of, you know, get the pads on, you know, get your hands on some pads and get a good feel for the game and everything. But what did you take away from, you know, the OTAs and the minicamp that you've been through so far?
Just technique, learning from the best, learning from the coaches, you know, taking everything serious every single day and coming out ready to attack and get better every day. Plus, like, you know, I learned a lot from the best. Brandon Linder, you know, guys like that, I learned from them, and they taught me a lot of stuff every day.
Now, speaking of Brandon Linder, he's one of our returning guys along with Cam Robinson and Andrew Norwell. All you guys are expected to be, you know, one big collective unit. What exactly have you talked to them? Because it's going to be all about chemistry. You got to be on the same page. And you feel that something that you've kind of chipped away a little bit?
Most definitely. They're great communicators, great guys, great group of guys. I look up to all of them. And, you know, they teach me a lot of stuff every day. But, you know, we're just looking to be the best we can be and get better every day.
Now, in the past, I want you to tell me the truth now. In the past, our offensive linemen to kind of have a pact where they got to be quiet. They can't talk about the media and everything like that. But tell me, how you been? What's the rookie Hazeman like? I know they got to have something for you.
Nah, nothing at all. I haven't done nothing to me, but I'm just enjoying. I'm having a lot of fun every day.
All right, man. So what are you most expecting to get out of this event from a personal standpoint? Obviously, you know, all you guys are here. It's got to be a great bonding experience from a rookie standpoint.
Oh, well, I'm used to this anyway. My senior year of high school, I did stuff like this, gave back to the community. I worked with special needs kids. I was a coach for a PE class. So, you know, this is what I'm used to, and I'm enjoying and having a lot of fun with it.
Now, my last question about training camp. This team is only going to go as far as the offensive line goes, you know, to protect the passing game, to open up holes in the run game. How much pressure are you expected to take on for your particular position? And is it really pressure at all? Just come out here and do what you do?
Yeah, no pressure at all. Just got to come in and work every single day, take coaching and, you know, listen, and just go out there and go hard every single day.
Now, my last question for you, the one thing that stands out of all the players here, it's your bag. What are we doing here, man? Tell me about the swag, man. What is this bag thing?
Okay, first off, you know, when you big, they don't expect the linemen to have a lot of swagger, but I'm just trying to bring that. I brought that to Florida. I'm trying to bring that here, you know. I think all big guys should have swagger. It shouldn't be just the little guys in the skill position, so I feel like that's how linemen should be, too.
As Jawaan Taylor, Jaguars second-round pick, maybe got a steal in the second round for the right tackle out of Florida. Marcel Robinson catching up with him and Gardner Minshew yesterday as well. So good conversations with those guys. Giving back to the community. Had a real fun day with the Special Olympians yesterday at Jags headquarters, and now hit the summer break, continue to break, and then back at it in just a few weeks for camp. You know, it was a month from yesterday Jaguars training camp begins.
Wow.
So it is getting closer and closer, and we'll see what happens with Jawaan Taylor. I'm interested in that whole situation. Cam Robinson, Obwehi, Taylor, where do they all fit? Left tackle, right tackle, swing tackle, who's healthy, who's not, who can produce right away? It's a big question, because I'm okay with what the Jags have in the middle of that offensive line, their interior. I think Andrew Norwell is going to come off a tough year and have a good one. I think Brandon Linder is going to be fine, and I think they're okay with AJ Cann. I mean, the right guard spot's not a spot you need to be a five-time Pro Bowler at. I think he's a fifth-year guy, veteran, enough experience, been pretty durable. I think he's fine, but that outside is so important. Health and productivity, how will they be? One of the big question marks going into training camp. Well, no longer a question mark. How much will Puz play? But always a question, what would Puz do?
Good call.
Ah. Paul Posluszny visits with Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690. Coming up next.
Action Sports Jax with Brent Martineau on ESPN 690 is brought to you by Best Bet Jacksonville and Orange Park.
Action Sports Jax with Brent Martineau, weekdays from 3 to 6 p.m.
I had no idea we were going to draft Blaine Gabbert. All right? Did your jaw just drop?
Yeah, it did. Did you sense the silence?
No idea. In fact, I left to go get something to eat because our pick wasn't for much longer in the draft.
You're supposed to pick 16th, yeah.
On ESPN 690.
Want a fresh one? Renna's Pizza is made fresh daily. Everything they make. This summer, while you're making memories, let Renna's add to the fun. Having a pool party? Get Renna's. Don't feel like grilling out? Get Renna's Pizza. Coming back from the beach? Enjoy 2-for-1 happy hour Monday through Friday from 3 p.m. until 6 p.m. Hey, the same time as you listen to our show on ESPN 690. Stay fresh this summer with fresh food and a refreshing happy hour at Renna's Pizza. 5 locations, Marsh Landing, Bay Meadows, Argyle Forest, San Jose, and Neptune Beach.
In an ocean of car dealers, there's only one Atlantic Infinity.
Only one Atlantic Infinity.
The only one for a luxurious showroom.
Follow the wave to the only one.
Atlantic Infinity. 10980 Atlantic Boulevard.
If you go to a traditional jeweler, when you're looking at the diamonds there in the showroom, from the time they came out of the ground, a lot of hands touched them along the way.
Diamonds Direct's Ben Peterson explains middlemen markups in typical jewelry stores.
Each set of hands that touches them adds a little bit of markup to the price and takes the best quality stones for themselves and passes the rest along to the next guy. So by the time you're looking at them, they've been marked up 3 or 4 times, and the selection has been dwindled down to kind of the bottom of the barrel.
But at Diamonds Direct, all those middlemen and their markups are eliminated.
Because we're diamond manufacturers, we're direct diamond importers. We're the only ones that are touching the diamonds from the time they come out of the cutting facility to the time you're looking at them in the showroom. We are in control of the whole process, and we pass the savings along to the customer.
The result is better quality diamonds for a lot less, and that's the Diamonds Direct difference.
Our unique concept and our unique value proposition and our history as diamond cutters makes us a destination, a bridal destination and a diamond destination.
Diamonds Direct.
We guarantee to offer you the lowest price on a diamond anywhere.
Get store hours and directions at diamondsdirect.com.
Get ready for your Saturday game at the local course, or get fired up for the next major championship in the middle of July. Hey golfers, this is Brent Martineau. The PGA Tour Superstore at the St. John's Town Center is a perfect place for your golfing needs. Golf attire, new clubs, golf balls, maybe even some shoes. Get your game looking and feeling like the pros. A one-stop shop for all of your golfing needs. Open daily 10 a.m. until 8 p.m. and Sundays 11 a.m. until 6 p.m. The PGA Tour Superstore at the St. John's Town Center.
And I had Jason Hill on a corner post that I just threw the ball slightly high on, right into the safety's hand. That was such a crushing loss for us.
Action Sports Jax with Brent Martineau. Weekdays from 3 to 6 p.m. on ESPN 690.
Brent Martineau.
You see him every day on CBS 47, Fox 30, Action Sports Jax.
Austin Lane.
He's a former Jag star and current MMA fighter.
Broadcasting live from the Anajar and Levine studio.
This is Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690 and ESPN690.com.
This has really been a fun month. The Jaguars in their 25th season here in Jacksonville, which is pretty cool. And of course, it's awesome to have the Jags here. We've been celebrating it all month long with different Jags players. Jimmy Smith, Keenan McCardell, Maurice Jones-Drew, Rasheen Mathis, Brad Meester, Russell Allen, Joe Zelenka, Kyle Brady, Cecil Shorts III, Will Blackman, David Garrard, John Jerkovich, Tim Cedar, that is, former kicker, Joel Schmange, Brian Sexton joined us, Josh Scobie, Jack Del Rio on Tuesday, Mike Sims-Walker Wednesday, Montel Owens yesterday, and we're going to finish it off in style with a fan favorite and one of the best to ever play the linebacker position in Jaguars history. Say hello to Paul Posluszny. What's happening, man?
Hey, how you guys doing?
Hey, thanks doing for good, we're doing awesome. Brent Martineau, Austin Lane here. Thanks for taking the time. I know you like to stay private and you're not big on these interviews, but we appreciate you jumping on with us for a few minutes.
Hey, anything for you guys. You know that.
Well, maybe for Austin Lane. I mean, I'm going to get right to it, okay? The whole month, I've been tallying how many people Austin got in fights with in practice. So that's really – I've been keeping a scoreboard. And I was thinking he would no way he would mess with you, but
– For sure, yeah, definitely
no
not.
Way. I didn't even think to ask that. But I've got to the my conclusion is that him and Evan Britton went at it like every day in practice. So what I need from you is, if you ever saw that, who won?
Oh, Austin every time.
I appreciate it. There it is, man.
You know I'm going with my defensive guy. You know, the thing about him, Austin's obviously high motor, very competitive. That's why I love playing with him so much, because you know that every down, you were going to get maximum effort all out. And, it showed. It showed in the way he played and the way he practiced.
Puz, you know, it's interesting, man, because people think of you as this intense individual, and make no doubt about it, you were an intense guy. But I found it kind of funny, like, off the field, like, even in the locker room before a game, like, you're never the guy to really crank the music up, or you even had headphones back when we were teammates or anything like that. Like, how did you approach the game? Because as soon as you crossed those white lines, it seemed like there's like a switch that clicked, and all of a sudden it was game time, and, like, when you looked at your eyes, man, you were ready to go.
I think always, you know how it was, leading up practices and games, there was so much of the mental aspect of the game that, for me, my mind needed to be clear and calm in order to be able to think about everything that we're about to do, understand exactly what I need to communicate to everybody, being at the Mike linebacker spot, but then once the ball snapped, then it's game on, and you can use all that built up energy, you know, and have fun playing the game of football the way it was supposed to be played. So to me, it was just there was an enormous amount of mental preparation where I knew I needed to be in control, emotionally in control. And then when you go out on Sunday, you can let it rip and have fun.
Former Jaguars linebacker Paul Posluszny with us on Action Sports Jax on ESPN 690. Brent Martineau along with former Jag and Pos teammate Austin Lane. Hey, man, how hard is it to play that middle linebacker spot with all the quarterbacking of the defense, the mental side you just talked about? The casual listener, the casual viewer of football, how difficult is that position?
I mean, to me, that was why playing middle linebacker was such a great challenge, because there was so much mentally that you needed to think about and make quick decisions and understand what was happening around you, and then being able to communicate that to your teammates so that collectively the entire defense would be in sync and working together. So looking back on it, that challenge was so much fun. That was one of the greatest things about playing football. But for a lot of guys, that's obviously getting accustomed to that and understanding all that it takes to play middle linebacker is a big challenge, because it's no longer you go get to run and hit people. That's obviously an enormous part of the job, but being able to think clearly, communicate, and help those around you is an enormous part as well.
Do you go to bed at night or wake up in the morning with like a call in your head still that like just kind of comes out, or you go back to, or you use the lingo? I mean, does it ever just pop back into your mind?
I still have dreams where I see the field through my face mask, and I'm communicating to Telvin Smith or talking to one of the D linemen and thinking about the things that we used to say. I mean, it becomes such a huge part of you, where, you know, you get it. It's so ingrained because you do it so much and you do it over and over again that, it's definitely a part of you forever.
Did you have a favorite call that you were like, man, call this again? Come on, Todd Wash, send this in again.
It's funny. That was a long list, because then you think about certain calls and what guys would be happy with that and what guys wouldn't, and what the DBs would like and what the D line would like. So, yeah, that would be a long list.
And I will say this too, especially on the defensive line. I mean, you know, there could be some miscommunications all the time. And whenever we turn back, you know, to pause for the call again, I mean, and it's like he said, like he would say it with such a calm demeanor, like, hey, it's okay, we'll get the call and it's all good. But then all of a sudden the ball snapped and, you know, this analyst gets unleashed and he's making a play in the backfield for 3 yards. So it's definitely a trait that you don't see a lot in the NFL, because you think of these middle linebackers just being these, you know, just jacked up kind of dudes, always intense. But yes, you have to pick your spot to be intense. So Paul was definitely that. Paul, I wanted to ask you though, so I mean, you're the prototypical middle linebacker. I mean, that's what everybody imagines you as, but let's not forget you also were asked to play the strong side linebacker towards the later part of your career. And I know you're the team player, the team first kind of guy, but really how was that transition to you, and did it kind of deal a blow to your ego a little bit to have to go from the middle linebacker spot to that strong side spot?
When we went through that, that was probably one of the biggest challenges of my career. Just 'cause, like you said, I I related so much to, you know, my whole football identity was tied up to being the middle linebacker. I was the person that was in charge of the defense. I was always in the middle. That position, you know, was what I became as a football player. And then to have that taken away for that period of time, that was challenging, because not only was I learning new techniques and new job responsibilities, trying to play on the outside, but you also had a loss of control. You know, it was no longer my huddle. It was no longer my job to communicate with all the teammates. So that was challenging. That was challenging because so much of me playing football professionally was tied up with, I'm the middle linebacker, and all the job responsibilities of that were mine.
Former Jaguars linebacker Paul Posluszny with us on Action Sports Jacks on ESPN 690 as we continue to celebrate 25 seasons of the Jacksonville Jaguars. Hey, man, could you still play right now?
Oh, I don't think so. I wish I could. I'm 20 pounds lighter than I need to be. So if I had a chance to bulk up a little bit, maybe. But that's one of those things where you know where the game is finally. You say, okay, it's not for me anymore. Unfortunately, that was the case.
Are you at peace with that now? Because my guess is you have to struggle with that for the first few months, maybe even the first year. But now that it's been a little time, are you at peace with the fact that your football career is over? Because you're a guy to me that would have trouble getting away from it.
Yeah, I guess I am. It's, don't get me wrong, I think about it every day, and I miss the game every day. I just, a lot because of missing the chance of being around guys like Austin, you know, and our other teammates, and being in the team environment and working towards a collective common goal with a group of guys. That's what I miss the most. So that, you know, moving away from that has been very challenging. I think about the Jags all the time. But you're right. I know that it's my time, and it's, you know, the transition has been challenging, but it's been a good process as well.
Yeah, I'm going to ask you what you're doing now, life after football, because I think there's a lot going on, or a lot on the table potentially for Paul Posluszny. But let me just stay on the retirement for one more second. In simple terms, why did you retire when you did?
Simply because I felt like I was no longer able to play at the level that I knew that I wanted to play at, and I didn't feel right about going back out onto the field for 16 games, knowing that that I was going to be a step slow, or I was going to miss a play, or physically I wasn't there. To me, that was just, I couldn't accept that. I guess I couldn't accept that. I'd rather step away, knowing that. The last time I played ball, I gave it everything that I had. I could play at my highest level, and I ended like that. I didn't want to slowly deteriorate in front of everybody, in front of my teammates, coaches, the fans. I wanted to avoid that.
Puz, so I've been sharing stories basically this whole month of the teammates that I played with, and like one thing that really
This is when guys usually hang up, Puz.
So one thing that really sticks out to me, whether it's in the locker room or it's on the field, just, you know, stories that I remember, things that stick out to me. And obviously, I have a lot about you, but actually, the biggest thing and the biggest story that I always go to that sticks out to me was actually, we weren't even teammates anymore. This would have occurred, I believe, in 2014. And what had happened was I was at the World Gym, and I saw the Jaguar strength coach, his name we call Milo. You know, Tom. Mm-hmm.
Still is.
Yeah, yeah. So he's there. And, you know, I was out of the league. I was still trying to get on a team, and me and Milo would talk back and forth every week. And I'd just be like, hey, how are the guys doing? And he told me that Puz tore his pec. You know, he had to have surgery on it. Now, I'm not sure if you're aware, Brent, but a pectoral surgery is a serious deal. Okay?
I was on the sideline when he tore it.
Okay.
I heard it.
Yeah, so you know what I'm talking about. So it's a serious deal. And I remember talking with Milo, I'm like, man, you know, that recovery is gonna be sucky, and it's gonna take a while for him to come back, and you know, we probably won't see him for a while. I kid you not, Brent, the very next week after Paz just had surgery, who was in the World Gym with one arm on the bench pressing with one arm, and it was Puz. And what I want to ask you there, man, is just, where does that work ethic come from? Because, yeah, we talk about the field and how you prepared for the game, but people never got to see just how hard you worked in the off season, how hard you worked in the weight room. Does that come from your upbringing, your support system? Where does that come from?
I mean, I think originally it was probably instilled by my dad. You know, the importance of perseverance and a strong work ethic was obviously he taught that that to me, my brothers and my sisters at an early age. And so I'm very thankful to have him in my life because he's had an enormous influence on that. And then just, I think going through college and early in the NFL, you're just able to see the results of that for any individual. You're able to see that, all right, if I know that I dedicate myself completely to this goal and I work at it and I have a great plan, then you start to see the results. So that was, I just knew, especially at that point, you know, I'd gotten hurt, you know, missed the vast majority of the year. I think I ended up missing 8 or 9 games that season, and I wanted to come back and be able to prove to, you know, my teammates and management and the fans that I was going to come back better than ever. So to have that as kind of your burning desire to be able to show people that you still, how much you love the game and how much you're dedicated to it, and you'll do anything it takes to be your absolute best, plenty of motivation.
Former Jag Paul Posluszny with us here on Action Sports Jacks on ESPN 690. All right, your daughter, and I don't remember how old she is right now, so I think she can talk, but and your wife, do they call you Puzz or Paul?
No, that's the thing. So few people, well, Puzz was, it seems like it was associated so much with football. So no, obviously nobody at the house, you know, my 4-year-old calls me dad, yeah, and the 2-year-old calls me dada, you know, and then my wife just calls me Paul. So that's why it's always, when someone calls me Puzz, it makes me think of football. So I love it. I love it every time I hear it.
That's awesome. So 4 and 2, two daughters?
Two little girls, yeah. And my hands full.
That always fascinates me. We used to do a segment on TV on CBS 47 and Fox 30 called Jags Dads. And especially, you are, like Austin said, I mean, you're the ultimate football player, right? You feel like that middle linebacker, throwback guy. And then you have two little girls. Tell us about the dad part of life away from football.
Oh, and they break me down too. They I am so soft around them. They had me wrapped up. There's no doubt about that. Having children, then having girls, it changed my life. You know, I had our first daughter. It was right before the 2015 season. She was born in July in the 2015 season. So it was just, it changes things, and it made me concentrate on football so much, because I knew when I was at work, I was fully dedicated to work, and I was doing, and then I was at that point, then I'm doing it for my little girl. And then you get home and you get to see them, and they run in the door and give you a big hug. It's the best part of your day. So it's been an enormous blessing having children.
That's pretty cool. What are you doing now? I've heard all sorts of things. I've run into you at the stadium. I know you were bending the Jags' ears from the business department and maybe going back and getting more schooling. I know you, I think you have your pilot's license and flying planes. What are you doing? Are you staying in Jacksonville? What's the life after football like for Paul Posluszny?
I mean, if we could stay in Jacksonville permanently, that would be great for us, because we absolutely love it here. My wife loves it here. My girls love it here. And then, I want to stay involved with the Jaguars. I told them as much as they want me to, as much as they want me around, I'd love to be around. And then actually start graduate school in late August. I'm going to a MBA program at Carnegie Mellon in Pittsburgh. But it's a great hybrid program that we can still live in Jacksonville while I attend school. So that's I'm looking forward to that, because that'll be a great challenge coming up.
Are you flying planes?
Yes, I mean just recreationally. So that was just a fun hobby that I picked up, you know, early in my career in Jacks, and something that that I love to do. It's challenging. It's a lot of fun. And something I really enjoy doing.
The story behind it here is, we all know that Miles Jack followed Paul Posluszny around everywhere, first couple of years of his career, even to the point he might have followed you to the airport and tried to pick up his pilot's license too. Isn't that true?
I mean, when he said, "Yeah, I'd love to start flying," I was like, "Wow, that's great." So I know that he's into it as well. I think he's well on his way to getting his private pilot's license. So, I mean, it's such a fun hobby. I mean, I'm glad I was able to have a little bit of an influence on him and get him involved in something that he enjoys.
Yeah, a little bit of an influence. By the way, he's making candles now, too. I don't see you doing that.
I heard about that. I need to ask him about that, because it's it's a very unique opportunity when someone says making candles. I mean, how you go about that, I'm not sure. I'll have to ask Miles.
Hey, he told us, he wants to stay at that middle linebacker position. How good can he be in that spot as he continues to grow? And did you think he got better at it a year ago when you did watch him play?
Oh, no doubt about it. And he can, I mean, the potential for him is limitless. He can be the best in the league because his athletic ability and how he's able to play and how and his natural instincts. Just the sky is truly the limit for him. When I first watched him there, especially the last couple of years, everybody knows Bobby Wagner, yep. the middle linebacker for the Seattle Seahawks. Outstanding player. Bobby is an outstanding player. Miles can be just like him because of how explosive he is, how fast he is. He can cover anybody. He covers so much ground. That's why it's going to be exciting to continue to watch him to progress and grow because Miles can be the best in the league.
Fuzz, I got a couple questions for you, a couple quick hitters here. You got to talk about the Peyton Manning interception for a touchdown. Now, I wasn't on the team at the time, but I remember watching it live. Is it probably your greatest football play of all time? How tired were you, especially in Denver? And can you just kind of take us through that a little bit with that pick six?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, probably one of the greatest plays of my career. And like you said, we were in cover two. Ball starts coming my way, and I'm thinking, I can't believe Peyton just threw that because it's Peyton Manning. You know, so he doesn't make mistakes. But yeah, was able to pick it off and take it back. And like you said, I just remember I couldn't breathe. I was so tired.
I remember seeing it.
running at that altitude. When I got to the end zone, it was almost like, oh, thank God. Thank God I'm here because I need a breather.
That's a little tidbit I have to bring up because I have you on the show, man, and I don't mean to put you on the spot here, but I think it was going in to the 2000 and maybe 12 or 13, I think it's 2012 season, after you had your big season here in Jacksonville, they ended up putting a giant painting of you in the entrance. And when I say painting, it's not like some kind of poster. This was like an oil acrylic kind of painting that stood tall and proud in the lobby when you walk into the stadium. My question to you is, what happened to that painting, and is it in your house right now? Because I would put it on my mantle off the get-go for sure.
No, I number one, we both thought that was completely embarrassing that was up because I just see it every day as I walk into the facilities.
Yeah.
You know, so I'll be walking into facilities with my teammates or something. We walk right by and I'm like, what are you doing? Like, how are you? It's just on the wall. Yeah. But no, I couldn't bring that home. I don't think my wife wouldn't let me bring it in the door. I don't think she wouldn't let me hang up something like that.
Puzz, I've actually tried to put a portrait of myself in the TV radio station here, and they take it down.
Mostly by me, yeah.
but that does speak to something bigger. How much does it mean to you in your whole career of all the accolades and all the big plays, the Peyton Manning pick, when you left, people said, what would Puzz do? That's what we should be asking. There was a Puzz standard in the linebacker room. Austin Lane talks about you all the time here on our radio show. I mean, it seems like you left an impact on so many different players, so many different coaches. What does that mean to you?
I mean, that means the world to me because you realize at the end of the day that, you know, being able to help your teammates and have a positive impact on the guys, that's the most important thing. So you know, hopefully, I was able to accomplish that a little bit because that's what's most important. You know, that's what's most. It's not how many tackles or interceptions or anything like that. It's going to be, did you have a positive impact on the people around you? Were you able to help the people around you get better? And if you're able to accomplish that, then you've done a good thing.
Do you now appreciate how much the fans appreciated you too? Because I know when you're going through that and you're kind of a humble guy and you're not really into all that stuff, but now that you've been out of it and you see people around Jacksonville in the grocery store or wherever else, I'm sure they still come up to you. When we ask people who we would love to get on the program, you were probably our top vote getter to get Paul Posluszny on the show. Do you appreciate that? Not say you didn't appreciate it before, but do you appreciate how much you connected with the fans here in Jacksonville and probably in Buffalo too?
I mean, it makes you realize how special I think Jacksonville really is and the people and the fans that support the Jaguars, because I've had the opportunity to talk to a lot of people. And just like you said, all over, you know, whether it's a gym, grocery store, gas station, doesn't matter. People will always come up and say, you know, thank you for everything, you know, thank you for playing, thank you for everything. And I tell him the same thing. I said it was an absolute honor to play here, absolute honor. The people have been so great, so supportive, regardless of the record or the situation or anything like that. The fans here have been truly great. So playing here was an honor and a pleasure. A large part because of that.
Yeah, you think 2017, you think about Paul Posluszny and getting that win and getting a chance to go to the postseason. I'm going to ask you about that in a second, but I'd be bad at my job if I didn't ask you about this. We all remember in the last couple of years your relationship with Telvin Smith. How surprised are you that Telvin is not playing this year? Are you concerned at all? How's he doing? What are your thoughts on Telvin's situation here in 2019?
I think just like everybody else, caught me off guard because the thing about Telvin, I know that he loves the game so much, and he's such a great person, such a great teammate. But he's a man of strong convictions, and he knows that if it's not right for him to play right now, then it's truly not right. So, I mean, just moving forward, just completely supportive of him and his decisions, because nobody loves the game of football more than Telvin. Nobody loves being a great teammate, more than Telvin. But for whatever reason, I know that now is not the right time to play, and I know that he will get back out on the field, no doubt about it, and he'll be better than ever. I mean, I know it's going to be a challenge this year because he's such an important part of the team, an important part of the defense, and I'm sure they're obviously going to miss him. But when Telvin gets back out there, he's going to be better than ever.
Buzz, you don't need to put 20 pounds on to play the weak side spot.
If I was as fast as Telvin, I could do it, but,
all right,
but that's not the case.
I'm going to end with this. The stat of your career was, I don't think it was ever on an eight team, maybe definitely a winning team. And then 2017, how much – I was a long wait, but all the losing seasons, all the battles and the tough times of being in the NFL, even though you were doing really well in your position, how much fun, even in somewhat of a reduced role, was 2017 to experience that, to experience what went on in Jacksonville in that locker room down at those headquarters?
It was unbelievable. Greatest experience of my NFL career, being a part of that team. Just like you said, I didn't play as much as I used to. But that, at that point, that didn't matter. It was being a part of that team and being around those guys and those coaches and that winning environment and seeing this entire community of Northeast Florida come together to support the Jaguars. That was such a unbelievable, powerful experience to see how important football can be in such a positive manner and how many people it can brighten their lives and brighten their day. But so to win and go to the playoffs, it made the 10 years of losing and continually fighting and struggling and always coming up short, it made it all worth it to be able to experience that 1 year with the Jags.
Yeah, it was pretty awesome for everybody here in Jacksonville. Hey, we all felt that, that kind of same ride in terms of the wins and losses throughout the years. You know, Austin's been trying to make a lot of bets in the show today. If he made a bet that you would coach or not coach at some level in the rest of your life, should he say yes, he will, or no, he won't?
Oh, yes, he will. Yes, I mean, I think I love the game too much not to do it. It's at some point and at some level, because I love to be able to help out and teach younger kids how to play ball and how to play ball safely but still aggressively. So, yeah, at some point, I think I would love to get back involved and help out where I could.
Hey, man, Paul Posluszny, former Jaguars linebacker, one of the best, and I know so many appreciate you here in Jacksonville. We really appreciate you taking a few minutes today and spending some time with us.
Thanks for having me on, guys. Great talking with you.
All right.
Great to hear from you, man.
Have a good rest of the summer. Enjoy the family.
Thank you. Take care.
All right, Paul Posluszny, former Jags linebacker, on a lot of different things, including Telvin Smith, that you just heard him said he will play football again. And this is a guy that's very close, obviously, with Telvin Smith. That relationship got real special over the last couple of years. But, come much better, right?
You know what? And as I reflect on my career, and then one day I'll tell, my son all the stories of me playing and everything like that, and we can have those good memories. The one that's really going to stick out to me are some of the guys that I played with. And when you're talking about guys that I played with, I bring up Aaron Campman, I bring up Calvin Johnson, but the guy that sticks out to me the most is Puz, because of just the way that he approached the game, the type of leader he was. Like, listen, there was a reason why I went to his retirement ceremony. okay? I mean, this is a guy that I probably honestly hadn't talked to since I saw him at World Gym maybe 4 years ago, but I was in town. I bought a house here. I heard he's retiring. He's having a ceremony. I'm like, I got to be there because he was my captain. You know, he was the guy that, and I put this in quotes, but you'd go to battle for. You know what I'm saying? He was just, he had that type of leadership. He had that type of aura around you. And you know, and I'm going to say this, man. I selfishly want him to coach, whether it's, you know, Pop Warner or high school, just so I can have my son be coached by him. Because I know, and this comes from the bottom of my heart, whether he wants to be a pilot, whether he wants to go, you know, in business, whatever Puzz chooses to do with his career, you know, after football, if he puts half the effort that he put into those teams that he played on, to the work ethic that he brought every single day, he's going to be successful no matter what he does.
Yeah, he's only got one mode, man, and that's the way he operates. It is a really cool thing. I think there was a section of the fan base and some of the fans, especially where we're seeing a lot of plays and tight ends, and you know, maybe Puzz was getting a little slower or older, and or just didn't fit that part of this scheme very well with down the field plays and in those coverages that started to get a little with Posluszny. But take that. I mean, that is, he is one of the all timers. Mm-hmm. In terms of pros, I have very few athletes that you can come across that is universally respected. Mm-hmm. Coaches, players, and you can feel it from my position.
Yeah.
I mean, there's probably guys. Like, I probably couldn't feel it from an Aaron Kampman way, even though he probably was.
Yeah.
But Posluszny, being around him and watching guys around him, mm-hmm. and watching coaches talk about him, and people in that building mm-hmm. talk about him. I'm talking about salespeople and ticket people about Paul Posluszny. I mean, it's, to me, it's got to be the ultimate honor as a player, or even as a worker. Forget about if you play in sports, right?
Yeah.
To be that well-respected.
Yeah, and like I said, I mean, it's just, it's some kind of aura about him, Brent. Like, he wasn't necessarily the most vocal guy, and it's like I talked about on the field. Like, if we had a question and we're in panic mode, he would relay the play call, but he would do it calmly. So he would put you at ease. So all of a sudden, well, if Puzz is calm, then I'm going to be calm, and I'm going to play better. But then when that ball was snapped, like I said, a switch would just go off, and it was just this animal. So, the guy had the gift to play middle linebacker, you know, and I don't
throwback,
think,
man.
Yeah, and they're not gonna make him like that really anymore.
Nah,
I feel like
a throwback.
Cut from a different cloth.
What's cool is he got beat up a bunch of times. He torn pec and some other things, and I think he even had injury when he retired that he would probably had to have surgery on if he were to come back at that time. But I think the good thing at playing that position, I think he's in good health overall.
Yeah.
As he leaves the game playing a long time, and that's beautiful to see.
And I told the story, like, listen, I mean, when I saw him in the World Gym, and I didn't really get into this whole story, but like he had like the bar, right? But he was holding it with one hand, and he was bench pressing with his good pec, and the other pec was obviously like he's in a sling. And this is literally a week after surgery. Brent, I had surgery after a week in my shoulder. I was laying in bed watching cartoons. Like, I couldn't get out of bed. And here you have a guy who has a more serious injury, a pec injury, and he's in World Gym the next week lifting already.
Yeah,
it's just, like I said, cut from a different kind of cloth.
What would Puzz do? Here's what Puzz wouldn't do. Yeah. He's probably going on vacation for the next 2 weeks. So I'm out. We're going to take next week off. We're going to go to a national program next week, 3 to 6, Will Cain show. Mm-hmm. So you can tune into that, of course, with the holidays. And then the week following, I'll be gone, but Stuart Weber will sit in this chair with you, Austin Lane, and Kuz will be here. So that's kind of the programming for the next couple of weeks. And then when I come back, it's all about football season. It's here, man.
Yes, sir.
I wish we could get Puzz in like every week, month, but he probably won't do it. He does not like to be in front of the microphones, be in front of the cameras, be in front of the spotlight.
Forget it. Let's just hire him out as a producer then. Take Kuz's job. He'll be the most intense producer of all time. Just kidding, Kuz. We love you, man.
He'll be nice and calm in your ear, though.
Hey, exactly.
Did you have to get anything in on Stay in Your Lane?
You know what? Just real quick, Brent, you talked about the UFC fights with heavyweights. They're kind of out of shape. Well, check out the one this Saturday. UFC 3 on ESPN. For sure get a better name, but it's going to be Junior Dos Santos versus Francis Ngannou. Ngannou's an absolute beast.
You've talked about him a lot.
Junior Dos Santos has the best boxing as a heavyweight, and it's going to be a really great matchup. So check that one out sure.
We'll do it. Have a happy 4th, everybody, and I'll talk to you in a couple of weeks. But for Austin Lane and Kuz and Marcel Robinson, thanks to Paul Posluszny for jumping on with us as well. Hope you have a good next week. And, hey, thanks for making this fun. 6 months in the books, by the way, here on ESPN 690. And we're getting a football season next.
I appreciate it, man. And thanks for letting me wear a tank top today. I appreciate that, too.
Yes.
I think Sun's out, guns out.
You should have worn a V-neck.
No, we're good, man. Tank top's all good.
V-neck or tank top? I don't know. But I'll see you on TV in a suit in a little bit on Fox 30 and CBS 47.
insight, and perspective you can only get playing the game.
I think you have a lot left to give. I'm not just saying that because we're former teammates, but I've trained with you, man. I've seen you in action, so I'm sending you good vibes. Wish you all the best.
Austin Lane, every afternoon from 3 till 6 p.m. on Action Sports Jax.
9 wins is the over-under right now. I can't remember the last time the Browns have been in the upper third of the league as far as that's concerned. Hey, it's Mike Golick from Golick & Wingo.
Weekdays from 6 to 10 a.m. This is ESPN 690. 4th of July is fast approaching, and you know what I heard? No, not fireworks. I heard that my friends over at Arlington Toyota are going to make your payments until after Labor Day. Free yourself from car payments this July 4th and buy a new Toyota from Arlington Toyota and make no payments until after Labor Day. During the Summer is on Us July 4th event, not only are you going to get a payment-free summer, you'll also get mind-blowing low pricing on 2019 Toyota models. This July 4th, drive away in a 2019 Corolla LE from Arlington as low as $13,881. That's a pre-owned 2019 Corolla for $13,881. Get 4th of July savings on a 2019 Camry LE starting at just $17,991. Yep, Arlington's got your pre-owned 2019 Camry for $17,991. Want a truck? Get a truck. As in 2019 Tacoma SR5 double cab from just $24,881. It's a pre-owned 2019 Tacoma for $24,881. It's the July 4th Summer's on Us sales event, and it's going on now at Arlington Toyota. Sales is open all day on the 4th. Start shopping now at arlingtontoyota.com.
Get ready for your Saturday game at the local course, or get fired up for the next major championship in the middle of July. Hey golfers, this is Brent Martineau. The PGA Tour Superstore at the St. John's Town Center is a perfect place for your golfing needs. Golf attire, new clubs, golf balls, maybe even some shoes. Get your game looking and feeling like the pros. A one-stop shop for all of your golfing needs. Open daily 10 a.m. until 8 p.m. and Sundays 11 a.m. until 6 p.m. The PGA Tour Superstore at the St. John's Town Center.
Dang it, I told you we should have installed a home standby generator.
You were saying?
Touche.
Keep your family prepared and safe during storm season with a home standby generator from American Electrical Contracting, the highest rated generator installers in Northeast Florida. For a free customized estimate, visit American-Electrical.com. Wired right at a fair price. American-Electrical.com.
Broadcasting live from the ESPN 690 Anna Jar and Levine Studios. Anna Jar and Levine Accident Attorneys. Call 904-600-4000. That's 904-600-4000. ESPN 690. Jacksonville's home for ESPN Radio. WOKV Jacksonville. Listen live everywhere you go on ESPN690.com. ESPN 690, a Cox Media Group station.
I'm Doug Brown. Team USA now with 10 straight Women's World Cup wins, tying the record held by Norway. Megan Rapinoe with two more goals today and a 2-1 win over France in Paris. The Americans also unbeaten now in 15 straight, tying Germany.